America's pastime and our nation's heartland. We are pleased to bring you the return of the College World Series from Omaha, Nebraska. The 74th year of this event reconvenes after a one-year hiatus. The fans are back and the teams are back. A week and a half for eight teams to decide who is the nation's best college baseball program. Fans are in the stands, we're in the booth, and we are ready to go. NC State here for just the third time, and Stanford back for their 17th College World Series appearance. And we start the College World Series from Omaha next.
The road to Omaha is no longer closed. After a one-year detour, thankfully, finally. One glance at this field, and all at once, that special Omaha feeling washes back over us. The Vandy boys are back, anchored by college baseball's best 1-2 punch, facing a bracket packed with talent. Arizona and Stanford are returning College World Series royalty, while NC State is here after unseating college baseball's king.
Hit deep to left. It's gone!
The dream of getting here has come true.
You know where we're going. Go to Omaha, baby!
The dream of being a champion has just begun. Welcome back to the College World Series.
Welcome to the NCAA College World Series presented by Capital One from TD Rosenblatt Stadium in Omaha, Nebraska. We start with a matchup of the ACC versus the Pac-12. NC State against the number 9 national seed Cardinal of Stanford. It's the first of two games today. Later tonight, one of the top pitching prospects in the game, Kumar Rocker, will take the mound for Vanderbilt against a red-hot Arizona offense. Bracket 2 begins play tomorrow. Welcome, everybody. It is great to be back in Omaha. Tom Hart alongside Chris Burke and Ben McDonald. We've got Chris Budden down on the field. We'll get to her in just a moment. Fellas, you both played in it, and we all missed it last season. So how great is it to be back?
It feels great. I mean, it feels great for us to be here. I know it feels great for the players. After a year where the season was canceled last year, we started with 64 teams just a couple of weeks ago. We're down to 8 now, and somebody's going to be a national champion in a very short time.
Yeah, I'm excited for the players. I'm excited for the fans. The great city of Omaha has their event back. And, guys, I'm excited to see who comes out on top because I feel like maybe the most wide-open field we've had in a long time.
We've got a week and a half to decide a national champion here. Here are the headlines coming into Omaha. What a field we have ready to go. Vandy with a 1-2 punch unlike the likes we've ever seen. Ryder and Rocker lead the country in strikeouts. NC State knocked off the number 1 national seed in front of a packed house in Fayetteville. They've got momentum. Texas back. The Longhorns for the 37th time will play for a national title. And we've got 4 projected first rounders on the mound alone appearing in this College World Series. So, let's start with game number 1. The Stanford Cardinal finished 3rd in the Pac-12. They had a great run in their super regional, Texas Tech. They're on a power surge.
No, they really are. When you think about Stanford, you know they can pitch. And the defense is a top 10 defense in the entire country. But what's been different lately is a much more physical team. 80 home runs on the year. And look, since the NCAA tournament started, just in 6 games, they have hit 21% of their total home runs. It's an offense that is averaging 10 runs per game in the NCAA tournament. So a much more physical, a much more offensive team for Stanford, and they seem to be peaking at the right time.
And on the other side for North Carolina State, what a long, strange trip it's been for the Pack. Preseason high expectations for this squad, led by Elliott Avant, their preseason top 15. After a slow start, they're here.
Yeah, it was rough the first 20 games, but Elliott Avant knew he had a veteran team, And since they've been rolling, look at that, the last 33 games, they are 26-7. It is a really physical offense. They have six players with double-digit homers, and Jose Torres was the story last weekend. Had three hits in Fayetteville, all home runs, including the game winner off probable Golden Spikes Award winner Kevin Copps that propelled the Wolfpack here to Omaha. This team is offensive, and they are scary.
When we return, Chris Budden will take us through Jose's story and how he led the pack to Omaha. Stanford and North Carolina State in game number one from the College World Series. From 64 teams, we're down to eight. A week and a half to decide a national champion. It's NC State and Stanford game one of the College World Series. For more on the path that NC State took to get here, let's take you down to the field as we say good afternoon to Chris Budden.
Hi, Tom. NC State's road to Omaha to go through Fayetteville, knocking off the number one team in the country in Arkansas. And it was thanks to a freshman, Jose Torres, at the go-ahead home run in game three. He told me that moment wouldn't be possible without his previous failures.
I was born in Dominican Republic. I came to the U.S. when I was 2 years old. My dad worked overnight because my mom stayed in the Dominican Republic. So when my mom got all her paperwork and she was able to come to the United States, we all moved into Baltimore. So that's where I live now. The ACC Championship, I was the last out. But I was just kept thinking, like, for the next time I have a clutch at bat, you know, I got to do something. So fortunate enough to have that moment again and send my team off to Omaha.
Torres told me it was a lesson he learned from his little league coach about how baseball is a game of failures. It's how you use them to make you better. And Tom, a big moment on a big stage from a young guy.
And the stage only gets larger for North Carolina State in their third ever trip to the College World Series. Last time they're here, they had Trey Turner, Carlos Rodon on the squad. See who we have, big leaguers to come. Starting lineup for North Carolina State, the batting order brought to you by Capital One, led by Johnny Butler in the three hole.
Yeah, and it's not just Butler, folks. From McDonough all the way through Brown, you got six straight hitters with double-digit home runs, the only offense in this tournament that can say that.
Stanford will send its ace to the hill, Brendan Beck, All-American Pac-12 Pitcher of the Year, the eighth in school history, toes the rubber for the Cardinal.
Yeah, he's been really good. He has been a real ace for the Cardinal, 9-1 with a 2.96, and boy, his last five starts, he has turned it up. 39 innings pitched, a 1.8 ERA, 53 punchouts, and only five walks over his last five.
And so after a year away, we are finally ready to go. The College World Series in Omaha. And Austin Murr will lead off for NC State.
Yep, here we go. Play.
Travis Katzenmeier is our home plate under our umpire. We are underway with a hot shot up the middle and over the bag. And Murr leads off with a clean single. No time to wait. Get out there and get swinging. NC State led by head coach Elliott Avent in his 25th season. He is a Raleigh legend. And he's got his team here for the second time. 19 appearances in the NCAA tournament in a quarter century as NC State's head coach. There last year in 2013. Pack fans are here too. Tyler McDonough at the plate looks at a first pitch strike. McDonough's a Cincinnati native out of Moeller High School. Baseball program produced Ken Griffey Jr., Barry Larkin, Stephen Larkin, Buddy David, and Mike Bell. A fantastic history in Cincinnati.
1-1.
Ball and a strike now to McDonough, the switch hitter. Ben, take me through the pitcher's mind. You're Brendan Beck. You take the mound in the College World Series the first game.
Trying to control your emotions. And the good thing for him, he's been a four-year starter for Stanford, so he's a veteran guy that's been out there. But still, the College World Series is different than any other start that you make. And the first time you step on the bump at the College World Series, you get an adrenaline flow that you just can't duplicate anywhere else. So if you're back right now, you're just trying to figure out the usual first inning stuff. Okay, how good's my stuff? Where's my command? Do I have my breaking ball yet?
And
you're trying to get into a rhythm. And it's a difficult thing to do because you're typically facing the other team's very best hitters out of the gate.
And that's what he has in McDonough, tied for the NC State team lead in home runs with 15. They were playing even with the bag at third and now backed off and going to miss to take care of McDonough.
Well, Beck can strike you out. I mean, 103rd innings pitch coming in. He's got 128 punch outs coming in. So make that 129. And the fastball for him is a good one. You can see the rotation. It's a good four-seam fastball. You can see Huff, the catcher, says, big boy, give it to me right out here on the outside corner. And it's exactly where it's delivered. So it's a lot of fastball command. You're not going to see 96, 97, but you're going to see a good fastball right around 92 with really elite command of it.
Runner on for Johnny Butler. Runner goes, swing and a miss. Failed hit and run, but a stolen base anyway for Murr. Just his sixth of the season. NC State trying to make something happen.
And you got a command pitcher on the mound, and you got one of the best bat-to-ball skill guys in all of college baseball in Johnny Butler. So I love the call, but how about the athleticism of Austin Murr to steal the base anyway? You don't see a lot of first basemen that hit leadoff, but a great jump. Butler swings through it. But still, the Wolfpack get a runner in scoring position.
90 feet closer now for Johnny Butler, led the ACC in hitting with a 377 average. He was even better in conference play alone. He hit 393 in ACC games. And we already told you how NC State got off to a slow start in conference, but boy, have they been on a tear late. They've won 31 of their last 40 games. Well hit, deep right field, Robinson, bye-bye, two-run jack. Johnny Butler, and the Pack's on the board.
Hey now.
There's been a power surge across college baseball in the postseason. It continues in the first inning of game one.
People were worried about how big this ballpark would play, but I'm telling you, folks, the ball is flying out no matter where you at this year in the postseason, and Johnny Butler proving just that with a rocket into the right field seats.
14th home run of the season for Butler.
Now, this NC State team can swing it. I mean, they're the only team here at Omaha that have six guys in double digits in home runs, and you make a mistake. And that was the first off-speed pitch we saw from Beck. It just happened to go over the fence.
Trail Tatum at the plate now. 10 of his 11 home runs came in ACC play. Junior from out of the Memphis area, Collierville, Tennessee. He's one of four players in this tournament that played together on a junior team that played here in Omaha. We'll see those guys throughout from Mississippi State, Tennessee.
2-1.
Breaking ball waved at. 2-2.
All right, 2-2.
And that's going to be a key for Beck right there. When he gets in those heater counts, those fastball counts, he's going to have to be able to land his breaking ball and his changeup in those type of counts. He did a good job there to get the count back even.
Tatum, first team all ACC, and he goes down on that check swing. Second strikeout, but Johnny Butler with one big swing here early.
Johnny Butler been hitting 390 all season with runners in scoring position. Looked like a backdoor slider, Ben, or maybe a changeup that he just yanked across the zone. And you see just how smooth that barrel gets to the front part of the hitting zone. And a rocket. That ball was not launched. That is a line drive into the right field seats.
And now Jose Torres, a super regional hero for North Carolina State. And not only did he provide the big blast, but he had a great super all the way through. Three hits, all three of them home runs. In a super regional that got off to a horrendous start. They lost game one to the number one national seed 21-2.
Got a safety late.
A little late on that one and fouls it off. But LA Davis managed his pitching staff interestingly in that game. They got behind early, and so he just kind of threw off the entire game. So we need to save arms if we're going to win here in Arkansas, and they did.
Well, he knows. I mean, you go down to his bullpen, there's some guys down there, but he's got two really good guys that he counts on down there that he can really trust. He didn't want to use those guys in the situation, so he said, you know what, I'm not throwing in the towel, but I'm going to see if some other guys can do it. And he gave up a lot of runs, but he saved his dudes, and his veteran club came out and said, you know what, we got boat racing game one, but if we can somehow win game two, and they did, all the pressure will fall on Arkansas in game three, and it did.
Torres also homered against Alabama in the regional opener, game one of that regional. And he sends a line shot into left. Jose Torres continues his torrid pace.
Right now, Beck does not have command of his off-speed stuff. So you get one for a two-run home run. That was another breaking ball, looked like left up in the zone. And this is the one you see really good. You see the spin, you see it hop out of the hand, and watch where it is. You talk about middle. You see catcher wants it down and away, but this ball is just about chest high, right down the middle of the plate. Torres recognizes it right away and finds a barrel to left field.
He's lucky he got that one back.
Torres held on by Bruiser over at first base. This will be the 18th pitch of the opening frame. From Brandon Beck, Pac-12 Pitcher of the Year. Catcher Luca Tresh. He has been the everyday catcher. He has played in all 53 games this season for NC State. It's a microcosm of where the depth is on this team. To look at it from a glass half full perspective, they know who the regular nine are, and those guys contribute in every way.
Well, this kid's got a chance to be a late first, early second round pick. So a big time prospect, can really catch and throw. You see the long ball, 15 large ones. And, you know, early in his career, sat behind Patrick Bailey. But now he is the guy, and, man, has he answered the bell this year for the Wolfpack.
Homered against Georgia Tech in the ACC tournament. And then hit two in Ruston in the Ruston Regional. Not the opening inning Beck was looking for. He makes his way off the mound after allowing a two-run home run at NC State on the board early. Two-run home run for NC State, and it's a 2-0 lead as we head to the home half of the first inning. What a run it's been for David Esker and the Stanford Cardinal. They went down to Texas Tech, and they blew through the Red Raiders. Second College World Series as a head coach. He was here with Cal in 2011, and he played here twice and won the 1987 College World Series as a starting shortstop. He has got quite a lineup to put on the field today. Let's take a look at the Capital One batting order for Stanford. Six games in the postseason, Ben, 17 home runs.
Yep, it's a deep lineup, but they're going to take their swings off their right-hander, Reed Johnston.
Brock Jones was a star against Texas Tech, 3-for-5 with 3 home runs in game two against the Red Raiders.
One of the most talented players in this tournament, certainly the guy to watch for in the middle of Stanford's lineup.
The face, Reed Johnston, on the mound for NC State, 8-3 with a 4.47 ERA for the 6'3 right-hander out of Enfield, North Carolina.
Yeah, 4 years he's been on this team now. Look, he begins the year, it's weird, he begins the year every year in the bullpen, but eventually finds his way into the weekend rotation. And we documented the start that NC State got off to in conference play. They dropped their first three series, but this young man was inserted against North Carolina the fourth ACC weekend, and all he did was throw a complete game, and that was kind of what got NC State rolling a little bit, and rolling they have been as of late.
But Johnston was not good game one of the Super against Arkansas. 7 earned in just 3 innings, what turned out to be a 21-2 loss. We'll keep an eye on his health in this one. They're not sure he's 100%. He faces Eddie Park to lead off. And the first pitch misses low. What will you be watching from Reed Johnston to see if he looks healthy?
Well, we talked to, you know, Skipper Avent, and Elliot told us, he said, yeah, I'm not sure what the injury is. He had a little bit of a growing issue not too long ago, but he's a tough kid, and he really doesn't tell us a whole lot what's going on. So I'm going to be looking at his stride. Sometimes when you have a growing issue, you don't really reach out with your leg because you don't want to extend too much. So I'm watching to see how far he's extending out. But he came out in the fourth inning his last time out, and he really wouldn't tell him other than he just wasn't healthy in his last start.
He threw a bullpen as recently as yesterday. They said it was an aggressive one. Two balls and a strike now to Eddie Park, freshman from San Jose out of Valley Christian High School, making just his 18th start of the season today.
Well, and a little bit of the play to start Reed Johnston is because this is their dude, right? This is the guy that the team wants to see out there in game one. So they're not exactly sure if he's clicking on all cylinders, but Elliott Abedin wanted to run his guy out there first.
Looks pretty good on that breaking ball. Then he strikes out Park to start the game. And that brings Tim Tawa to the plate for Stanford. He's a senior from West Lynn, Oregon. And a Stanford team that last year did not have a great year in the COVID-shortened year. And so Tawa back for a senior season, 281 with 11 home runs on the season. Great postseason, an OPS of 1262 in the NCAA tournament.
Yeah, and one of the stories of this Stanford team is they are having banner years by their seniors. Tim Tawa, Christian Robinson, and Nick Bruiser, all seniors, all have played fantastic ball this year for the Cardinal. A big reason they find themselves here in Omaha.
Four of his 11 home runs have come in the postseason. And yes, this Stanford team is going with the postseason lip sweaters. The mustaches are sweet.
One ball, two strikes, one and two.
Tawa was a high school football standout at a West Lynn High School. Three-time Gatorade football player of the year as a quarterback. And that one just missed, two and two.
And Tawa's multi-dimensional defensively. He's played center. He's played short. This year, he's playing second base, a premium athlete. And as you said, a high school football star as well.
He rewrote the Oregon high school football passing record book as he slices this one foul. He told me yesterday his favorite opening play, and ran primarily spread, was a play-action post corner. He said, we catch you sleeping. We're going to hit you for a deep ball right off the bat. And Stanford needs to answer NC State's deep ball here in the first.
Yeah, Johnny Butler likes that play call, too. With a little post corner himself into the right field seats.
Butler in left field for State. Here's the 2-2 from Reed Johnston. Hammered foul. We heard Chris's story about Jose Torres and failure leading to success. Tawa lived that. They lost a high school baseball state championship game on his error in the seventh inning. He said, I couldn't leave the field. The next day before we left town, I had to go back to the field and just see where the mistake happened. And he goes down swinging on a slider. Back-to-back K's for Johnston. So base is empty for Brock Jones, who is the super regional superstar. He is the energy for the Stanford team.
We talk about Tim Tawa being a two-sport star in high school. Brock Jones came to Stanford as a football player as well, and he put the power on full display last weekend in Lubbock. Three bombs, all to the middle of the field, all no doubters. This kid is a premium athlete, plays center field, no longer playing football, and one of the guys to watch in next year's draft.
Stanford, if you're not aware, has a long and storied history of football and baseball. Two sports standouts, starting with their former head coach, longtime head coach Mark Marquess. I was talking to Brock about it, and he said, I did have some guys I could lean on. He talked to Toby Gerhardt about it. Grounder to Furs. And Murr will toss. That was closer than maybe expected. Johnson covers the bag. He puts them down in order on 14 pitches. 2-0 pack as we head to the second. The NCAA College World Series is presented by Capital One. What's in your wallet? And in part by Fairlife. Bring more to the table with Fairlife Ultra Filtered Milk. Tom Hart, Chris Burke, College Baseball Hall of Famer Ben McDonald, Chris Budden down on the field. Game number one of the College World Series from T.D. Rosenblatt, and a home run from Johnny Butler. Just the second NC State player to homer in the College World Series. Fred Combs did it against Texas in 1968. And that one fouled into the seats. Pardon me, TD Ameritrade. I went back to your all's playing
just
days.
Just about, yeah.
I mean, I went here for a year. You give me a break?
This
yes,
is a,
of course
this
we will.
This is a much more friendly pitching ballpark than what the old one was.
Uh-huh. You would know?
Unfortunately, yes.
Devontae Brown at the plate for NC State. And Brandon Beck is able to drop one in ahead in the count 0-2 after a slow first inning for Beck. There you go. Fourth strikeout, all four outs via the K for Beck.
Yeah, the first three with a fastball, and he's starting to get the breaking ball going, and that's what he needs to get going. That's what he got hurt on with the two-run home run by Johnny Barrels. He barreled that one up, but watch this breaking ball. Look at the catcher Huff on the outside corner. There's the dot on that slider. Perfectly placed. I don't know if you can do it any better than this. See the dot on the front? There's one on the back as well, and he places that one just on the outside part.
Interesting part about this NC State roster, nine starters from eight different states and another country. This is Vojta Menšík from Brno in the Czech Republic. NC State discovered him when they played an exhibition game against his team from the Czech Republic.
First ever player from the Czech Republic to play in the College World Series. Congratulations to him and his family. What a neat story.
Been around baseball for a while, was a volunteer at the MLB London Series in July of 19 and plays for the Czech national team. They played a couple of exhibition games against State back in 2017. He did say that the Arkansas crowds they played in front of were by far the largest. He said even the best stadiums back home seat maybe 200 people. Little dribbler out in front of the plate. Huff got a hurry and it gets wide of the bag and down the line. Menšík will go into second base. Just the third throwing error of the season by Stanford catcher Cody Huff.
And that is uncharacteristic of the Cardinal and their defense. You're talking about a team that came into this tournament feeling 985 in the postseason. And this is an opportunity to get an easy second out. And not a routine play, but certainly one you'd expect Huff to make. But Ben, he spikes it. Bruiser can't finish it off. And the Wolfpack get a runner in scoring position off a swinging bunt.
Well, that's what speed does to you. Menšík getting down the line quickly, and Huff knew about it, so he had to hurry his throw. And instead of making a good throw, a little bit short, and Brewster on the back end couldn't pick it out of the dirt.
Straight error on Huff, and here's JT Jarrett. Who very nearly had a unique Father's Day celebration this weekend. Shows bunt, pulls back his dad Link, the head coach of Notre Dame. The Fighting Irish took Mississippi State to three games in their Super Regional in front of 41,000 people in Starkville over the weekend.
Wow.
JT Jarrett, the nine-hole hitter for NC State. Grew up in Greensboro. His dad previously the head coach at UNC Greensboro. 29 sacrifice bunts in his career, most of any active Division I player. What do we think? Like, what's the run total? How many runs wins this thing today?
I would say based on the experience of the two starting pitchers, I'm feeling like a 5-4, 6-5 kind of game. I think both offenses are just too talented to completely shut them down, but I expect both these pitchers to compete, and we know they both have guys at the back end of that bullpen too.
Off the plate. Caught the edge, 2-1.
The interesting thing about Jarrett is he is known for his glove, and this NC State defense is one of the best in college baseball. But he has been red hot in the postseason. Coming into this game, 9-22 in postseason play. 9-21, excuse me.
Yeah, he hit 400 in the Super. He fouls this one back 2-2. NC State was playing in Fayetteville about the same time Notre Dame was playing in Starkville against Mississippi State. His dad, Link, said, that was the first time in my life that I coached the game while watching the out-of-town scoreboard.
We had a little bit of that going on. Mike Bianco and his son Drew Bianco were both in the Supers. Pretty cool stories there.
Head coach of Ole Miss and center fielder for LSU, respectively. 5 Ks now for Beck.
Well, there's two different breaking balls for Beck. One's a slider, and then there's the curveball. This one was the curveball. So fastball's been 92, 93. He's been spotting it really good away, but watch this breaking ball here. So the slider early, and that's more straight over the top. There's a rotation. There's your vertical break, and again, placed perfectly on the outside part of the plate.
Back to the top of the order now in Austin Murr. We're talking with David Esker about Brennan Beck's development as a pitcher, and he said, you know, he wasn't a high velocity guy when he got here, but he had pitchability, and he had to have pitchability in four different pitches to be successful, and then the velocity came.
Yeah, and that's what you're seeing, and that's what you hope you can do is get these guys on campus, right, as freshmen in their upper 80s kind of guys, maybe 90, but you develop them. They get bigger and stronger in the weight room, and all of a sudden the velo ticks up, and certainly his has. But one thing he's always been able to do is throw strikes. He has always been a strike thrower, and anytime, look, he had 100 innings pitch coming in, only 23 walks, 128 strikeouts. So he's a strike thrower with those two different breaking balls. The changeup we have not seen yet. I've not seen one. Most everything's been breaking balls and fastballs at this point, but it's a four-pitch mix.
Murr at the plate, junior from Denmark Township, Minnesota. And a fake back to Menchie. Murr played junior college ball, Des Moines Area Community College. He's one of two here from Stillwater High School, Drew Gilbert, one of the Tennessee Stars. Been in the same high school team for a couple of years. That high school team, by the way, held tryouts on spring break. They had to go somewhere warm, leaving Minnesota, so they went to Kansas City.
I hear it's beautiful around early April. That's wild. How about two kids from Stillwater, Minnesota playing in the College World Series at the same time? That's pretty cool.
Catches the edge, 2-2.
Boy, if he gets that one now, that ball to me looked like about three balls off the outside corner. But well, we see it a lot in college ball. If the catcher sets up and you can hit the glove, even though it's off the plate a little bit, if you can consistently hit the glove, a lot of times at this level, you'll get those calls.
Beck allowed three hits and a two-run home run in the first. He has struck out five through an inning and two-thirds. And that one brought back up by Huff, but not close
enough.
Look
up, 3-2.
And, Ben, that's the typical, like, if he's going to give me that one, I'm going to go right back there, right?
If I can get you out without throwing you a strike, why would I?
Exactly.
Right? Why would I? But you got to be able to recognize that. And you hope if it's a strike in the second inning, it'll be a strike again in the fourth inning, again in the seventh inning.
And if you get that, you might be around for the ninth inning. Two complete games for Beck on the season. Payoff.
All right here.
Fouled off of his foot.
And this is where this NC State lineup gets so tough, right? You got a base open, so the tendency is that maybe I don't have to challenge. But, man, after Murr, it's McDonough and then Butler and then Tate. I mean, the front half of this lineup never quits. And that's why they find themselves here, because this is a lineup that can really hurt you.
Yeah, because after Murr, it's six guys in a row, double digits in home runs.
Mm-hmm. And now with Butler's home run. 14 home runs in seven postseason games for NC State. Payoff to Murr again.
To me, if you're Murr, Brendan Beck has not thrown one inside fastball. So you put your toes on the white line and you refuse to get punched out looking on a heater away. And then do your best on a breaking ball, right? I mean, he has not thrown one four-seamer underneath the hands of any of these lefties. So here in a full count, you have to take that pitch away from him.
And that's surprising for a guy that has really good fastball command. And you're right. He is going to have to show fastball in occasionally.
3-2 breaking ball missed inside. First walk of the game from Brendan Beck. And that'll bring McDonough back to the plate. He struck out in the first. An error and a walk, and two outs in the second inning for North Carolina State. Third College World Series for the Pack. Last time they were here, Trey Turner, Carlos Rodon were the stars. Pickoff to second. Walk me through that as a pitcher and a shortstop.
Well, I think right now the Stanford defense realizes the urgency of the moment. I know it's just the second inning, but they already got two on the board. You got one of the best hitters in the lineup right now with two on and two out. They're trying to get off the field, right? If they can steal out three, they're going to try to.
Base hit right field. Menchik will come around from second. Throw goes to third, and Murr takes it in the back. NC State keeps it rolling here in the second.
And it's just such a talented veteran lineup. Guys like Tyler McDonough have had so many of these at-bats, and he is not going to let Brendan Beck flip a first-pitch breaking ball in there and get ahead. Watch his first-pitch curveball. He sees it and rips it into right field. And this is what you'll see from some of the best teams in college baseball, the ability to sit on a breaking ball in a two-out RBI situation, and the Wolfpack are red hot to start this one.
Yeah.
And look who's at the plate now. Johnny Butler homered in the first.
Hey.
Got a first beach ball of the year on the track. We didn't realize I'd missed beach balls so much. State fans taking advantage of the opportunity here for just the third time. Sam Esposito brought the 1968 NC State team to Omaha. That was their first visit, and back a few years ago. 1-0 to Butler. Ben's long arms could reach that one, maybe. Here's what happened in the first. Johnny Butler.
Yeah, it looked like a breaking ball, almost a backup breaking ball, just kind of set right in the middle of the plate. And Johnny Butler, of course, with the 48 RBIs and 13 home runs, he knows exactly what to do with that one.
Nine straight wins for the Pack when Butler homers.
Hey, now.
Call that a trend?
That's pretty loud right there. This is a real guy right here, and you can tell Brendan Beck is paying a lot of respect to him right now, staying on the edges. And Elliott Avent telling us he thinks he flies under the radar a little bit, but first team all ACC, third team All-American, led the league in hitting. This is a guy that has all of college baseball's attention, certainly Brendan Beck's.
And it almost feels like Beck understands first base is open, and he's really not wanting to throw a strike. And that was called a strike, but clearly it looked like to me just a little bit off the outside part of the plate. But you got a guy on deck you punched out the last time you saw him, but the guy standing in the batter's box hit a two-run home run. So careful here.
Butler from Shanahan, Illinois. Goes out swinging. Sixth K for Beck. But NC State has jumped in front 3-0. Through two.
Welcome back to Omaha. NC State up 3-0. Only two coaches in history have won as a coach and as a player. Stanford's David Esker hoping to be the third. He won as a player back in 1987. When I talked with him about what he remembers about that year, he said it was a lot of hard work. They came to the College World Series the year before. He said, I never saw the field. I charted the entire series. He said, I did everything I could to try and get on the field that next year. He said, the thing that team had, that our team also has, is a brotherhood. It takes grit. It takes a togetherness. He sees that same thing out of his current team.
Yeah, he was behind an All-American in 1985, and he said, that's just the way it was, but I promised myself I'm going to be on the field next time, and we're going to come back. And you knew that team well, Ben. That team was loaded, led by Jack McDowell.
Yeah, Jack McDowell on the bump. Of course, first rounder had a ball drift foul, but first rounder had a really nice big league career. Ed Sprague at third base.
Real dude.
Big time dude that had a nice big league career too. And it was a gritty team by Stanford, you know, and they took their lumps last year. We talked about it. I mean, a young team that got beat up on a little bit last year, but look, a lot of experience, a little bit of a slow start this year, but they are rolling right now.
Well, we're going to find out their togetherness and grit, because their ace is on the bump, and he's taking a couple punches here to start this ball game. So they're going to need every ounce of that grit here in this one.
Meanwhile, the question was whether or not NC State's ace Reed Johnston was healthy. He certainly looks like it. He's retired all three and ahead in the count to catcher Cody Huff, 1-2.
Yeah, I'm looking. I don't see anything. I'm looking at his stride. I mean, we talked about the potential growing issue that he has, but the stride looks good for a big guy. I mean, he reaches out there at 6'4".
Huff sends this one high to left. Butler. One down with Christian Robinson coming up. For more coverage of the College World Series and interactive brackets, go to NCAA.com. Big one tonight. Vanderbilt and Arizona.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to that one. I mean, you've got an Arizona offense averaging over 8.5 runs a game, one of the tops in the country. And, of course, Kumar Rocker seems like on the biggest stages, he really elevates his game. So that's going to be a big-time matchup tonight.
Yeah, one of the most famous college pitchers, certainly of the recent memory, got a chance to pitch in primetime where the last time we saw him, he was carrying his squad to a national championship.
Shift is on for Christian Robinson. And the count goes a ball and a strike. Got Jose Torres playing to the right of the bag at second. They'll leave Wojtek Menchik on the left side of the infield.
Ball.
Robinson spoils another. Senior from Melbourne, Florida.
It'll be interesting to see how Johnston offers these left-handers because it's mostly a fastball slider mix. A few changeups here and there. And so you feel like the lefties for Stanford have an advantage with that breaking ball constantly coming into him, right? He's going to have to locate the arm side fastball and he's going to have to bury that glove side slider. If not, we've already seen the ball jump to right here today with the wind blowing across just a touch. And so to me, Johnston versus the lefties of Stanford is definitely a matchup to watch in this one.
I think the fastball away followed by his changeup, and he's supposed to have a pretty good changeup. If he can get those going on the outside part of the plate right out there, he's going to be pretty good. Right now, he'll sink the fastball, and that was a two-seamer on 92 right in the outside part of the plate, perfectly placed. But if he can come behind that with the lefties, with that changeup out of the same window, he'll have a lot of success. Take a look at this. You see Tresh set up on the outside part of the plate, and there's that two-seam spin just kind of oozing down and away. A really good pitch. So as it travels towards home plate, it travels at 60 feet, 6 inches. It's in the zone most of the time, but right there toward the end, he just leaks it off the outside corner.
First pitch in for a strike to Nick Bruiser, senior from Chandler, Arizona.
How do you get the two-seamer to ooze, Ben?
You better ask Johnston because he's doing it pretty good right now.
Just ooze it.
You just want to ooze it. You want to start it just about knee-high and have it sink down. In a time where a lot of guys are just kind of throwing four-seamers up in the zone, this guy likes it down a little bit. But it looks like to me he'll throw both of them. He's got the two-seam that sinks a little bit, but he'll grab the cross-seamer, the four-seamer every now and then, too, and ride it.
So real pitchers have the riser and the oozer.
Oh, yeah, like you have to have an oozer.
I think if you can do both, it gives you a better chance, you know.
I agree.
Any pitch that ends in heater, riser, oozer, breaker,
it's normally good.
Right.
Seven of Bruiser's 11 home runs came in Pac-12 play, and he sends a shot to right coming in, and diving catch made by Devontae Brown. NC State second in the nation in fielding percentage, flashing some leather here in the second inning.
Devontae Brown did not get a great read on this one, but fortunately he's got the athleticism to make up for it, finish it off, the Wolfpack off the field.
Welcome back to the NCAA College World Series presented by Capital One.
I know.
What do you got?
What we got there?
Are we going to get into the debate again of snowball or snow cone?
No, we all know it's a snow cone, but
it is not a snow cone.
It oozes onto the ice, you're working with something.
It's kind of a snow cup.
Yeah, there's no cone there. It's a snowball. Thank you.
Well, I didn't say snowball, but I don't know why.
Regardless, they're delicious.
It looks good.
We did have a year off from this conversation, so it does feel fresher than it would normally, you know?
Here's Terrell Tatum leading off the third for North Carolina State. Post-game Zesto, anybody?
I'm in.
Nice breaking ball. Another K coming for Beck. Well, he led the Pac-12 in strikeouts, led the Pac-12 in whip at .95, and he is showing his stuff here in this one with the K he's going.
Yep, two different breaking balls, slider, and again, this is the curveball. You got one on this pitch right here, so he starts it just about belt high, and there's your vertical break, almost straight down. That is a real curveball there.
And early, it looks like the curveball is better than the slider.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he got hurt on the slider early. And that's the thing about early in the game is trying to figure out what kind of stuff you have and what breaking ball is going to work for him. And it's nice to have two of them. And he's realized the slider's not very good today, so he's going mostly to the breaking ball as of late.
1-1.
First team All-ACC shortstop Jose Torres from Baltimore, Maryland, by way of Miami and the Dominican Republic. Born in the DR. Lived there till he was two. Grew up in a baseball family. The two rivals down there in the Dominican where he grew up, Lise and Aguilas. Mom was a Lise fan and dad an Aguilas fan. That's like Red Sox Yankees down there.
What a neat young man. Came up, introduced himself to us yesterday. And I don't know if we've got a lot of coaches here that will gush about their kids, obviously,
yeah, sure.
You know. But I don't know if you can say nicer things about a player than Elliot Avent says about Jose Torres.
Guys, such a gem to talk to. He talked about how when he was 2 years old, he moved over here with his father. It took his mom until 2012 till she was able to come to the States. But that love for baseball started so young. She said he never played with cars or dinosaurs like little boys. It was baseball since day one.
Yeah, he grew up a big Jose Reyes fan in the Dominican. And his mom took him a game at just 2 years old.
And look, he's a young man turning out a lot of money. Mm-hmm. I mean, Coach Avent told us, you know, six figures easy, well into the six figures, and decided he wanted that college experience.
24th round pick by the Brewers in 2019 coming out of Calvert Hall.
Outside.
Prep in Baltimore. That one just missed. 3-2 now.
Well, and you got to give Chris Hart, the third base coach and recruiting coordinator, longtime recruiting coordinator for North Carolina State, the credit for finding Jose Torres, because he was not exactly on everybody's recruiting watch list, and he said the first game he ever saw him play, he made three errors in a minute. You know, somebody stops him. You gotta go see this shortstop. Okay, I'll go check him out. But he's like, man, he could really move, and you could kind of project the frame. And so he went back and watched him the next day, and he made all the plays, and the rest is history.
Good thing he came back to watch him again, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, Coach Hart said it was like 10:30 at night, and some guy said, hey, you got to go watch Torres play. He walked over, and like you said, I mean, he made some errors quickly, but there was something about him he wanted to see again.
Crampton, the shortstop, calls for it. Two down, the first out not coming via the strikeout. Tomorrow afternoon on ABC, ESPN Deportes and the ESPN app will have Game 1 of the Western Conference Finals between the Clippers and Suns. This is L.A.'s first ever conference final, the Suns' first since 2010. But a comeback for the Clippers last night, erasing a 25-point third-quarter lead thanks to 39 points from Terrence Mann. You had Terrence Mann as the guy who dropped 39 in that game, didn't you?
No, I missed that one.
Luca Tresh at the plate for NC State, down in the count, nothing and one.
I tell you, Ben, most of the time if you were 2 2/3 into a ball game and had six punch-outs, you'd probably feel like you were doing pretty well. But it's really been a tale of two games for Beck at this point, right? I mean, he's been dominant with the put-away pitches, but every mistake seems like it's been hammered by this team.
Well, and that's been the NC State offense for some time, is they're not missing many mistakes right now. And you're right, when Beck's made good pitches, he's racked up the strikeouts, but when he's made some mistakes, he has paid for it. But the breaking ball to me is starting to get a little bit sharper. The curveball, he's starting to land on even more and more.
And there's another one. 8 Ks through three, but a couple of big hits and a costly error for Stanford. NC State has a 3-0 lead. Let's take you inside the action. Up cam right behind it, and a close look at what Brennan Beck is offering for Stanford. Ben, think how many fish are in there.
A bunch.
That's it, a bunch. From Omaha, Nebraska, here's Drew Bowser leading off the third for Stanford Cardinal. He comes from a Stanford family. His mom, Yvette, 1987 Stanford alum, member of the Multicultural Alumni Hall of Fame. So first African-American woman to develop her own primetime series with Living Single. Also worked on Black-ish, a producer on A Different World, Cosby Show, and on down the line. And Drew played his high school ball at Harvard Westlake. If you follow Major League Baseball, you may be familiar with that school. Jack Flaherty, Max Fried, Lucas Giolito, all on the same staff.
And his high school teammate, Pete Crow Armstrong, was a first rounder in last year's draft. Bowser was a potential first or second rounder, but let scouts know that he was one to head to Stanford.
Sends this one sky high to shallow right. Brown, Jarrett, and the second baseman ends up with it. Oh, pardon me, the right fielder ends up with it.
Ooh, this is one of the things you'll see every team when they get here to TD Ameritrade and they get their chance to practice. They will all go through pop-up communication because spacious outfield, sometimes a high sky, or you got to be able to communicate. Jarrett's underneath it, but Brown calls it late, and I tell you what, Jarrett whiffed it. Ben, watch, Jarrett whiffs this ball, and Brown fortunately keeps his focus and finishes play off. Look at that. Wow.
Yeah, Devontae Brown didn't see that ball again. He got another bad jump. He actually broke back on that ball as well, but came flying in again. The speed makes the difference of getting there.
Here's Tommy Troy at the plate, 8-hole hitter for Stanford Cardinal without a hit so far, and he punches one to Murr at first. He'll toss to Johnson coming to bag. 8 up, 8 down. What a start for Reed Johnson after giving up 7 earned in 3 innings against Arkansas last time out. Here's Adam Crampton, the Stanford shortstop, and they're going to bring the corners in for Crampton, a 282 hitter with just 2 home runs. Fourteen multi-hit games for the sophomore from Oakland, out of Oakland Tech. And Johnson behind in the count to the 9-hole hitter. Crampton played on Team USA a few different times as a youth, including the 12 and under team, won gold in Taipei.
Ball four.
And a 4-pitch walk, first base runner of the game, comes from the 9-hole.
Is there anything that would make you more mad than a 4-pitch walk with 2 outs and nobody on to the 9-hole hitter?
No. And he didn't see it coming because Reed Johnson's control has been really good. And it's a little bit different arm slot. You know, he steps a little bit across his body, but it's a low 3/4 slot for me. And that's what allows him to sink that ball when he wants to down and away to the left-handers. But he's also got that sweep and breaking ball going across the zone as well. So he's got one going left to right, one going right to left.
Four stolen bases on the season for Crampton. Stanford's not a team that's going to run a lot. 48 stolen bases on the year. They have fewer stolen base attempts than NC State has stolen bases.
Hey. And really, this is a matchup. I know Park punched out his first at bat, but this is a matchup that should suit Park. He loves to hit the 6-hole. He loves to work the backside of the field. And you got a guy in Johnston that likes to throw those arm side fastballs, those two seamers that run away. So watch out for a bullet to left or in the 6-hole here to get Stanford going.
And he sends a flare into shallow right, late jump for Brown, but he's there in plenty of time. 2-out walk is all we've seen so far from Stanford. And when we return, we'll talk to their head coach, David Esker, about his return to Omaha. Tom Hart, Chris Burke, Ben McDonald, happy to be joined now by Stanford head coach David Esker. David, you've been here as a player a couple times now, yes. Back here as a head coach. What did you tell your team about those experiences leading into this week?
Well, I just told them, you know, they got to be able to play loose and get their feet on the ground and just be relaxed. We haven't really done that as of yet, but we'll get there. We'll get there. They got to play loose.
Coach, talk about Brett Beck, your pitcher, a little bit. Looked like the first inning, maybe the breaking ball wasn't quite as good, not as sharp, but he's got a feel for it now, it looks like.
Yeah, he does. He does. He's been making some pitches. You know, we haven't helped him much on the defensive end there. Probably had a guy out dead to rights on a hit and run, and then a ball we threw past the first baseman. So he's done a good job so far. Maybe threw that changeup a little firm to Butler, but, hey, they're good hitters. They're going to make you pay.
Coach, thanks for your time. We appreciate it.
All right.
Head coach David Esker, the ninth head coach to play in the College World Series and then lead his alma mater back to Omaha. He was also here as a head coach with Cal.
Interesting little nugget right there. So that was a changeup that Beck cut to Butler, because that ball came back all the way across the plate. And you notice we haven't seen too many of those since.
Since then, yeah. And that's the key. I mean, the circle change is obviously supposed to go the other way. Mm-hmm. That one he got around and he actually cut it. And he cut right back over the center of the plate.
Here's Devontae Brown, struck out looking first time up, sends a fly ball deep right field. Robinson all the way to the fence. Ooh. It's gone! Solo shot, Devontae Brown. He wasn't sure. Stopped at second before Billy Van Rapper says, touch them all.
Well, boys, if we had any questions about how big the ballpark was going to play this week, I would say we're getting our answers. I don't think Devontae Brown got all of that one. I mean, this is a fly ball to straightaway right field, but obviously Brown, with a ton of power, gets a fastball up in the zone and launches it to right center field. He wasn't sure that he got enough, but the ball is carrying here this afternoon.
It is jumping. There's no doubt. When you go oppo in this ballpark, it says something. Ball's flying pretty good. And how about that bat control? Knowing where the barrel is, and he goes up to a ball that maybe wasn't even a strike and goes up and gets it.
Second plate appearance for Menchik. Reached on an error by Cody Huff last time up on a swinging bunt. Thirteenth home run of the season for Devontae Brown. Only 9 home runs allowed all season for Beck, and 2 in the first 4 innings today. That was a home run swing for Minshew.
2 balls, 2 strikes, 2-2.
Sharply hit and handcuffed by Tawa. And Menchik will take advantage again of a Stanford miscue.
I don't know if this will go as an error or a hit, but this ball smoked a hanging slider, and Menchik just rips it at Tawa, and he does all you can do. You try to block that thing up and hope it falls in front of you. And you can see he just kind of turns into a catcher there. But the ball hits off the heel and kicks to the side. And Stanford continues to just not quite make some plays that they've maybe made throughout the course of the season.
Ruled an error, and JT Jarrett, the 9-hole hitter, to the plate with one on and nobody out. Tries a bunt, and that one will be popped up but foul.
So Dave Esker points out the fact that they had a chance to cut down Austin Murr on a hit and run, where Huff throws the ball to the shortstop side, right? Then Huff throws the one against Menchik, his last at bat, down the right field line. And then right there, a really tough play from Tawa. But again, one you know he certainly can make. And next thing you know, it's just been a very shaky start by this Stanford defense.
And it's a different appearance for Stanford, given the confidence with which they played in Lubbock against a very good Texas Tech team. They came out swinging. They never trailed in that one. And that one goes off of Huff and will allow Menchik on a wild pitch to move to second.
Yeah, let's not forget, this is a top 10 defense in the entire country. And right now, the defense is hurting Stanford. This bug ball typically is blocked up by Cody Huff, the catcher, but simply just shoots to the right.
Just didn't corral that one, Ben. The chest kind of sticking out. He didn't get the right shoulder around it to direct that ball back in front of him to home plate, and that is an easy advance there by Minchie.
Well, and that's that new catcher stance that we're starting to see, right? You're down on one knee, and I wonder when you're down on one knee, can you physically move like you want to get that forward lean and square your shoulders towards the pitcher's mound to block that ball and keep it in front? But it's kind of the new thing that we're seeing with a lot of catchers, especially at the big league level, where they feel like they're still in a few more pitches along the way by framing some balls and stealing some pitches. But I think it hurts them a little bit when it comes to blocking balls.
I don't think there's any question about that.
Yeah, watch where Huff is. See, he's going to go down right there. He's going down to one knee. And when you get all your weight to one side, see, he wants to shift over a little bit and try to square up more. And he doesn't quite get there in time.
He just doesn't get around it, right?
Right.
And like you said, you're down on one knee. It's really tough to move laterally.
Pitching coach Thomas Seeger with a visit for Brandon Beck. And the infield.
1-1.
And it counts a ball and a strike now to JT Jarrett. Pitching depth is typically key in the College World Series, so Stanford up against it in the sense that this is their ace, Brandon Beck, and they haven't picked up the ball cleanly behind him. He's let two balls leave the yard. And you'd hate to waste a good start from your ace in a scenario like this because you weren't focused defensively.
Yeah, but I tell you, you're behind, and you obviously you want to win this one. You're all in for this one. But you, I expect him to be out there for a very long time, regardless of the way this one goes, because, as Dave Esker said, this is our horse. We're going to ride him. You look at the innings pitched all year long, already over 100 innings on the season. So they're going to leave him out there, regardless of even if the Wolfpack tack on a couple more, would be my guess.
That one brought up 2-2.
Yeah, because he's not a guy trending in the wrong direction,
no.
Right? We see a lot of pitchers this time of the year when the innings and the pitches have mounted a little bit. They're not trending as good as they were. You look at what Beck's done lately, and we talked about it. His last five starts, he's pitching to a 1.8 ERA. So he's been at his best lately.
Seven straight quality starts, but for just the second time this season, Brandon Beck has allowed two home runs in the same game. Johnny Butler in the first, Devontae Brown here in the fourth. To first, handled there by Bruiser, and it goes across the diamond. Bowser chasing back, and now Crampton will get involved in the race, and he gets the tag. Well, the accolades for Bruiser as a defensive first baseman, well earned.
That was special right there. And I was just about to credit JT Jarrett for the beautiful piece of hitting on a backside ground ball with a runner at second base and nobody out. But Bruiser makes him pay. Watch this one. No hesitation. Put your foot in the ground and rip it across the diamond. And even though it has not been a great start by the Stanford defense, you can put a star by that play because that is a big-time play by the senior at first base.
A race to lead runner, Jared aboard on the fielder's choice. Back to the top of the order in Austin Murr. Murr, like a lot of guys playing in this College World Series, has been to Omaha before, came in with a youth team in 2013, had a chance to take in a game. You'll see that throughout the week. Little League tournaments and youth teams come in for the local tournaments and get an opportunity to go to the bleachers and watch guys playing at the highest level of the college game.
Yeah, one of the neat parts about this week, right? The city of Omaha hosts all these youth tournaments, and it's just a great way to grow the game. Get exposed to, you get to compete, right, at your level, and then come and see amateur baseball played at the highest level.
Oh, my, into the left side and past Crampton with Bowser headed back towards the bag, and Stanford got caught out of position on an Austin Murr sing-ice single.
Yeah, it looked like the shortstop Crampton kind of shaded over more towards second base. The ball wasn't hit hard, but perfectly placed. Almost right off the cap of the bat over that five and a half hole.
It's nothing you can do. Crampton gave it all he had, right? Just comes up a touch short. He's not going to throw out Jared anyway.
Even if he gets to it, he's not getting anybody out, but still a nice piece of hitting.
And so here's Tyler McDonough, the NC State center fielder. They'll run some guys down into the Stanford bullpen, and we'll wait for them to clear. Quinn Matthews will start to get loose. What's you know, in the big leagues, you don't necessarily see the guys warming up behind you in the bullpen. A little bit different here.
I think so for Beck, because when you see the guys come out of the dugout, it almost makes you know you got to pick it up. You got to pick it up a notch or two. You're not going to be in the game much longer.
Well, I think there's a couple ways to look at this. One, you could say, okay, if he gets us out of this one, we'll let him go maybe 120 pitches and pitches deep into the ballgame if he can find it. The other thought would be, let's get him out of there because maybe we need him again mid next week, right? So if we get him out of there at 70, you know, 77, let's say he even gets to 85, maybe he could come back on short rest if you can stay alive.
Trying to get out of trouble here with two on and one out facing Tyler McDonough. And Beck has gone over 100 pitches in each of his last three starts and six out of the last seven.
Well, his last start, he was really good against Texas Tech. Career high 13 punchouts. He worked seven and a third. Only gave up the two earned runs and punched out 13. Only walked one that day.
Dunna pops it up.
No tag, no tag.
Jones and Park, and the left fielder Eddie Park for the second out. That's a big one, it feels like. Especially with the heart of the order. Now Johnny Butler coming up.
Yeah, that was a big one. You got the big one left. Because Johnny Butler's already showed us what he's capable of. Now, the adjustment last time by Brendan Beck was keep it away. He was caught on a cut changeup that Butler deposited in the right center field seats. And something tells me we're going to see a steady diet of the outside part of the plate this time around as well.
But I still think Beck has to do some work with his fastball on the inside part. We've not seen that one time today. Even if you don't throw it for a strike, at least make him think you might come in there because it'll only open up the outside part of the plate. But most everything has been arm side.
Breaking ball low. Double steal on the pitch in the dirt. The throw to third was wide. And NC State takes off on a short breaking ball.
Well, this is what NC State will do to you. I mean, you look at the stolen bases on the year. They're second in the ACC in stolen bases. But they will take an extra 90 on balls in the dirt. And this is a good dirt ball read here. Sees Jared out at second base. Bounce, bounce. He sees it, kicks away, and there's no hesitation at all as he takes an extra 90.
Something tells me Chris Hart was a little anxious as Jared goes with two outs and two on with your best hitter up to bat. But all's well that ends well. Now you got to – are you pitching to him? I mean, I know we're early in the ballgame, but you pitching to this dude with first base open in a 4-0 game?
Very carefully. I think if he wants to get himself out on some balls like that right there, I think you pitch to him. But I think that's where the ball has to be. It's on the corner, but you got to know where to miss. So it's on the corner and off. Maybe some breaking balls down out of the zone.
Got Tatum on deck. He struck him out twice. Elliot Avan had a great description of Johnny Butler when we met with him this morning. He said, this guy's really good. He's Johnny Damon without the hair. Same spot, another one for a strike. Leading the ACC in hitting.
1-2.
Had a great regional, hit 400. Drove in five as NC State went on the road to Ruston, Louisiana. Knocked off host Louisiana Tech twice.
That's indecision right there. You got 1-2, so you're thinking put away, you're thinking punch out, but you know who's up to bat, and you're going, do I really want to throw that pitch?
Well, for me, the pitch is fastball in, but it's in on the corner or it's off the plate, and then maybe goes back to the bread and butter, which has been away.
Came in on the hands, and that one is dumped into right field. It'll get two runs home as Murr crosses the plate. Johnny Butler is driven in four through four for NC State.
Breaking ball. He does try to come in right here, but look where this ball is. It's kind of leaking in just a little bit, and it's in on the label right off the hands. But you talk about Butler and his strength. How strong is this guy? The ball not too far off your hands, but strong enough to fight it off and get it over Tawa's head. You see Tawa going out to second baseman, but just can't get to it. And there's two more runs for the Wolfpack, now up 6-0.
Here's Tatum 0-for-2, couple of strikeouts. Ooh, and yeah. Got him! Johnny Butler picked off to end the inning, but not before State does some damage with a home run from Devontae Brown. And Butler, a couple ribbies on a blooper. It's a 6-0 Wolfpack lead in the middle of the fourth.
So David Esker pulled everyone over to have a team meeting here before this last inning to discuss a little motivation. Also, Brandon Beck came up to me. I'm sitting in the corner of the dugout. He looked at me, kind of laughed, and goes, "This isn't going well," but with a smile. So
it's Tim Tawa leading off the fourth inning. And Ben, you can see just by the stuff that it's not a typical performance from Brandon Beck.
No, he's just not as sharp as we've seen. Certainly not as sharp as his last time out, you know. But again, you know, he's given up 6 runs, or 3 of which were earned. So if a few defensive plays were made, it changes the whole complexion of this ballgame. Right now, big lead for NC State.
Yeah, I think also, like this is a super deep and talented lineup, but Johnny Butler hits third for a reason. He's their best hitter. And so far, they've had 4 at-bats, and their best hitter has 4 RBIs. So, the inability to execute against the other team's best hitter will get you in trouble.
Oh, well hit down the left field line. Gone if it's fair. Ooh. And it is both. Tim Tawa powers one over the wall, and Stanford is on the board. First hit of the game for the Cardinal.
That's kind of what you do with a hanging breaking ball right there. And that's recognizing it, too. Recognize it out of the hand, because this ball almost starts right on the inside or almost right at Tawa. But watch this move to the baseball. And this is a long one here. You're right. We put everything to rest where the ball was going to fly. And there's a hanging breaking ball just kind of sits inner third. And those are the ones, Berkey, that you really recognize it and you sit on it and you find the barrel. And Tawa does.
That ball almost got to the concourse.
I'm telling you. Hey!
Brock Jones looks at a first pitch strike.
How about Tim Tawa? Now 5 home runs in 7 postseason games.
Well, I don't know what the message was the last half inning, but
it worked. That's good coaching.
That's pretty good coaching.
We call that a good meeting.
Yeah.
Back deep into the bleachers. Brock Jones at the plate. He was a football player for Stanford his freshman year, special team star. We're talking about the two-way guys, two sports stars in Stanford's history. Brock was at a baseball game years ago, and there's a middle-aged man sitting behind him that talked about the time and effort difficulties in playing both football and baseball at Stanford. He said the guy had some really good information. Oh. As he sends this one to center, he said, "I didn't find out until the 9th inning that I was talking with John Lynch, the GM of the 49ers.
Turns out he knows a thing or two about a thing or two.
Yeah, indeed. Sweet mustache for Brock Jones, and this Stanford team kind of went the facial hair route for the postseason. Everybody in.
Everybody has?
Yeah.
I don't know about y'all, but I couldn't grow a mustache in college. There's no way.
Cody Huff, hot shot to third. Mensheet gathers. Here's Chris with more.
Not everybody has the stash. Hmm. Brendan Beck doesn't. The guys say his reasoning is that he shaves before every start. The guys think that is just an excuse for the fact that he can't grow one. Brock had the best quote, though. He said, "My mom hates it. She also hates all my tats, so she probably won't hug me all week."
Yeah, without hugs from mom. That's right. It's Father's Day. Dad, former Army Ranger, said, "Yeah, I love it. Go for it." Christian Robinson at the plate, 0-for-1 to the strikeout. So Torres on the right side of the bag.
Oh.
To first, and Murr has it. Leadoff home run from Tim Tawa's got Stanford trying to find some momentum. See if Brendan Beck can continue. And when we return, we'll talk with NC State's head coach Elliot Avan about the return of the Pack to Omaha. Packed house at TD Ameritrade. It's a 6-1 lead for NC State over Stanford. Happy to be joined by NC State head coach Elliot Avan. Elliot, you've been here before with your team. It was a few years ago. What did that experience, how did that help you now getting your team prepared for this week? Hey, coach, we're talking about your experience a few years ago with NC State. How did that experience help you get your guys ready for this trip?
I don't know. Every team's different, but it definitely relaxes me a little more, but it's just great to be here in Omaha with this great fan base and the way this city welcomes everybody here.
Yeah, embrace everybody, and your fans have showed up. Thanks for your time. We appreciate it. We'll get back to the game.
Thank you.
It's Elliot Avan, 25 years as a head coach at NC State.
Boy, is he a hoot to talk to, huh?
Yeah.
That's fun. That's good stuff. Like, he ain't holding nothing back.
Here's Harold Tatum for NC State. This is a Wolfpack program here for just the third time. They're here in 1968, and that was a kind of a Cinderella run. They were unranked in 1968, lost to the national champions USC in the semis, one of Rod Dato's national titles. He had nine big leaguers in that squad. And we talked about the up and down season for North Carolina State, top 15 team Division I baseball, preseason top 25, and they finish 35-18, five games over 500 in the ACC, lost a 1-0 game to Duke in the ACC title game. How would you summarize NC State's season?
Well, I would obviously tailor two seasons, but I don't think anybody's surprised that they're here. Now, maybe surprised who they beat to get here.
Uh-huh.
But if you go back to the beginning of the season, all Baseball America, D1 Baseball, everybody thought this was the most talented position player group, maybe them or Louisville in the Atlantic Coast Conference. Right now, the pitching was banged up, and obviously it's very thin, and so you just weren't sure. And even Elliot Avent told us he wasn't sure they had enough pitching with the way they started to get here, but their starting pitching has really carried the load, and the offense has ended up being what everybody thought they would be, which is one of the best groups in all of America. Mm-hmm.
The everyday nine for Avent have hit all 89 home runs and contributed all but two RBI this season. They have the nine, they have the five pitchers. And when we talked to him today, he said, listen, if we want to have success here, this game is a must win for us. We just don't have the depth to go through the loser's bracket.
Well, and the tournament's set up for them, right? We've seen this in the past. Virginia back in 2015, like teams with just four or five on Michigan just a couple years ago getting all the way to the finals. Like, you don't need a ton. If you can win with the off days here, if you've got just a couple that you trust and a couple dudes in the back of the bullpen, you can win the whole thing.
You can make some hay. Tom, you talked about it, but from a player standpoint, Berkey, you can speak to position players. It's nice to come to the ballpark and know you don't have to look at the lineup card like you're in there every day. And I think this is a team, while there hadn't been a lot of change, and they've been able to stay reasonably healthy position player-wise, but a lot of kids know that they have a couple bad games, they may find their way on the bench. It's not been the same for this group. It's been the same dudes in the lineup all year long, and I think that means a lot confidence-wise to a group, knowing I don't have to go check the lineup because I know I'm in there every day.
Here's the weird stat for NC State. They're about a 500 team at home, 13-12. Away from home, 22-6. You've got to be a good team to win on the road.
Yes.
Yeah, it shows their maturity. And obviously what they did last weekend in Fayetteville just shows what this team made. Really a microcosm of their whole season, right? It starts off really bad, like 21-2 bad. And next thing you know, you're making history against the sport's best pitcher in Kevin Copps. And it wasn't an offensive explosion. Kevin Copps still, you know, had a legendary performance. But their pitching held up, and they did just enough offensively to win that elimination game.
Overall, they led the ACC in batting average, scoring, and slugging percentage. We've seen them slug a couple home runs in this one. Foul territory, a lot of ground to cover, and that went off the back of the tarp as Bowser Couldn't quite find it. Two up and two down for Brendan Beck here in the fifth, including his ninth strikeout of the game, getting Jose Torres looking a moment ago. Pitch count really jumped up.
One ball, two strikes.
Last inning, he faced six batters in the fourth. Was able to get pickoff to end the frame.
Ball.
Two and two.
Two and two.
And Tresh goes down swinging. Double-digit strikeouts for Beck once again. He tries to go deep for Cardinal. Bottom half of the lineup due up for Stanford, trailing by five. Welcome back to the NCAA College World Series presented by Capital One. First College World Series, 1947. It's been held here in Omaha since 1950. They did not have drones in the first Omaha World Series.
I saw that thing flying around a while ago.
Popped up, and Murr nearly to the railing. Great awareness. Nick Bruiser retired. One down with Drew Bowser coming up. The big one tonight, Kumar Rocker. Most outstanding player of the 2019 College World Series will be on the hill for Vanderbilt, taking on a powerful Arizona team. Chat lasted Ole Miss and their Tucson Super Regional. Tomorrow, Tennessee and Virginia, and the nightcap, Texas and Mississippi State. First pitch strike to Drew Bowser. Kumar Rocker seems to be at his best in the biggest games.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I had him a couple of times, as you guys did, you know, in the middle part of the season. His velo dropped in about two or three starts in a row, and there was some concern because I had him when he, against Missouri. And it was a cool night, but only 88 to 91, and so there was concern there. But I just think he's a guy that needs to be challenged, you know. And when he challenges and gets challenged, he seems to rise to the occasion. You see what he's done in his career, 21-9. How about the NCAA tournament? An ERA of 0.63 and 6-0. So on the biggest stages, he always seems to show up.
You know who he reminds me of a little bit in the spirit of the U.S. Open week? He's kind of like, you know, college baseball's Brooks Koepka, right? Like, I mean, he's always great, but there is a even another level of greatness that I feel like Kumar can find on the biggest stages, and he's shown it to us over and over again. So this Arizona offense, which is real, talking about led the Pac-12 in batting average, doubles, triples. And so he's going to have his hands full against a very talented Wildcat offense. That's going to be a fun one to watch.
It'll be the biggest test of the year for him. And I had talked to head coach Mike Bianco. Of course, they played Arizona in the Super Regional. And Mike Bianco said, this is the best offense we've faced all year. And don't forget Ole Miss faced Arkansas, Vanderbilt. Mm-hmm. They faced everybody. And he said, by far, top to bottom, because they're going to run out. Arizona's going to run out nine dudes hitting over 300. That's how deep they are.
That's an Ole Miss team that started the season by sweeping the Big 12 schools, the Texas schools out in Arlington. Here's Tommy Troy, the DH, 0 for 1. Stanford one hit on this game. It came from Tim Tawa, no doubt home run in the fourth.
No balls, three strikes, no two.
Come on. Let's go, baby. Keep fighting, baby. 5-4 right here, Tommy.
Troy homered twice in the regional from the Friday game against North Dakota State, Sunday against Cal Irvine. Regional went the distance. They had to beat Irvine twice, and then they swept through the Lubbock Super Regional. Outscored Texas Tech 22-3. Base hit through the left side for Troy. Second hit for Stanford.
Tommy Troy's got a nice future ahead of him. He's going to be a real dude for this Stanford club, and just a true freshman. Nine homers, going to be an infielder eventually when, you know, Tawa moves on, and he has had a heck of an NCAA tournament coming into this one. Hit 333 with three homers. One of these real talented youngsters that Dave Esker runs out there.
Here's Adam Crampton. Sanford finished third in the Pac-12. You mentioned their youth. The future is bright, and no doubt about it. Are they ahead of schedule? Like, are you surprised that they're here this year?
Yeah, I think when you think about 5-11 last year before COVID and the number of freshmen and sophomores that are in the lineup, I think Dave Esker would agree that they're probably a year early. He liked his club. He liked the potential of his club. Just wasn't sure based on last year and a couple of the young pieces they were going to lean on. Could they put it all together? And boy, have they. And it's been a pretty consistent run.
They'll keep Troy near the bag. 4 of 5 on the base pass this year. Seventeenth College World Series for Stanford. And Johnston picks up 2 Ks here in the fifth, working around the second hit allowed. He has looked magnificent for NC State. He's got plenty of offensive support and a 6-1 lead.
Yeah, Reed Johnson's got it going. He's put all those potential injury things we heard the rest of this point. That two-seam fastball is really working NC State with a big lead, 6-1.
What a great camera compliment we have at TD Ameritrade this week, and that includes UmpCam. If you want to watch every pitch from behind home plate, simply log on to the ESPN app. We'll have UmpCam going all tournament long. There's a great look. Travis Katzenmeyer has got it on, and we certainly appreciate the umpires for helping us take you inside the game. Devontae Brown leading off the six. He homered last time he was up. And he sends this one deep. It'll be the second of the game for Brown. No, caught at the fence. Eddie Park used all of the park to pull that one in.
Maybe just a touch off the end of the bat. And this is where the teeth of TD Ameritrade will bite you as a hitter. You can see that little crevice there where the bullpen ends. Eddie Park gets back there. Nice job of squaring up, knowing exactly where he is. Still had a couple more feet. And I think Devontae Brown just caught that one a touch towards the end. But nice play there by Parker, knowing his ballpark.
Well, that was a good look at the wind. You can see the flags in the background kind of blowing a little bit in, a little bit left to right. And that might have been just enough to hold that one in the ballpark. Because when it left, I think we all thought it was gone.
Wojtek Menchik at the plate. He has reached base on a pair of Stanford errors in this game. Came around to score after reaching on an error by the catcher Cody Huff back in the second. Hey. 3-1. There you go. Perfectly played by Tawa. Two down.
Here we go, boys. This is why this one didn't get out of here. You could just tell it was a slider here from Beck. Let's see if it was a breaking ball. Yeah, a little slide piece that he catches just towards the end and maybe a little too much of the bottom of the ball. And that's the design there, Ben, right? Just missed the barrel. Now, this one probably caught a little more of the barrel than he wanted, but just enough to end up in an F7 instead of Brown's second homer of the ball game.
Here's JT Jarrett. You can see Quinn Matthews getting loose in the Stanford bullpen behind Eddie Park. 104 pitches so far for Beck. Beck threw 126 in a game against Arizona back on May 7th. And then he had another heavy workload, 121 the game after that. Tied him up 2-1. JT Jarrett 0-2. What a performance by his dad's team, Notre Dame, to stretch Mississippi State to a final game in Starkville.
Yeah, it was an incredible performance, but man, they were really up against it playing there in that rowdy Starkville environment. You know, you look back at it, it really doesn't make a lot of sense that the ACC champs, not just the champs, 4.5 games,
yeah,
were playing on the road in the Super Regional. And Notre Dame, if you're Link Jarrett, you probably feel like you're at an Omaha club. But to have to go on the road and win in that environment, they just came up a touch short. But a fantastic season by the Irish. And Link Jarrett, just his second year there in South Bend.
His slugger, Nico Cavadas, hit a home run that the Mississippi State guys were able to laugh about when we met with him yesterday. Two-out walk to Jarrett. And they, you know, the outfielders said, yeah, you hear about home runs where the outfielders didn't move? None of us moved. We just watched it go right over our heads. Now, Father's Day coming up tomorrow. There's Dad Link, played at Florida State, head coach at Notre Dame. Chance to make some great memories this week. Would have been even more special for the Jarrett family had the Fighting Irish made it. Looks like that's going to be the end of the line for Brendan Beck. He struck out 10 over 5 2/3. But a little off early, gets tagged for a couple home runs, and he'll leave with Stanford trailing by 5. We'll tell you about the new pitcher, Matthews, in a moment.
Well, kind of a strange day for Brendan Beck. When he was good, he was really good. We saw the fastball up to 94 miles an hour, balls, both the slider and the curveball. But it was mistakes that got him. Johnny Butler got him in the first inning. And then it was Devontae Brown goes the opposite way. And then again, Butler with a two-run single. So he ends up giving up 6 runs, only 3 of which were earned because of a couple of errors mixed in there. But 10 punch-outs, a pretty good day. Got the pitch count up, and so he is out of the ball game. We're going to take a look at Quinn Matthews now for Stanford.
Matthews, a 6'3 lefty, will face Austin Murr at the top of the order with one on and two out. 17th appearance, 5-2 with a 6.15 ERA. Matthews didn't pitch in the Super Regional against Texas Tech, but a couple appearances in the Regional against UC Irvine. Will have 4 runs over 4 2/3.
Has been one of their guys on the weekend for most of the season. And what you'll see, fastball slider mostly to the left-handers, fastball changeup mostly to the right-handers. Big first opportunity right here for a freshman in the College World Series. Come in here and face the talented hitter like Austin Murr, trying to keep your team in this game. My guess is they're going to plan on a long stint here, right? Maybe if you're Dave Esker, you're thinking maybe Matthews can take us the rest of the way and the offense can make a run.
I think that's what you're hoping for.
His last 3 outings, he's gone 2, 3 1/3, and 4 innings respectively. So certainly has the history to give him some frames. Murr's got a couple of hits and a walk. He scored 2 runs today for NC State. It's a 6-1 Wolfpack lead. They're trying to end an interesting trend. Stanford has won its last 7 College World Series openers. Back-to-back national championships, 1987 and 88 for Stanford. Two and one. If you're wondering about Beck's performance today, it does have a historical note attached to it. The 6th pitcher to strike out 10 batters in less than 6 innings pitched in the past 50 College World Series.
Wow.
One of those others, guy by the name of Mike Messina against Georgia in 1990. It turned out to be pretty good.
Yeah.
Something tells me most of those pitchers probably got a W in their start. Just a very odd performance, but the mistakes were really capitalized on by this NC State offense, which that's the kind of team they have. They can really make you pay when you miss.
Yeah. Jarrett 3-for-4 on the base paths this year.
When you wonder with all these picks if there's not a breaking ball coming. Usually when you see a pitcher pay that much attention to a base runner, he's trying to keep him close because he wants to bounce a breaking ball. It's weird, right, Ben? Like, why would you pick that many times on a guy who's got three bags and then throw a heater away? Like, if you want to steal on a lefty on a fastball away, have at it, right? Like, it's just interesting that they're paying Jarrett that much attention. But here with the full count, two outs, they will play the first baseman back.
Off and running, the 3-2. It's low for ball four. And here's Tyler McDonough. Beck 9-1 on the season. Only decision he could take is an L in this one. McDonough's an interesting story. Sophomore from Liberty Township, Ohio, originally committed to the University of Missouri in the fall of 2016. He's a sophomore now. He didn't commit to NC State until about a month before he arrived on campus. Ooh, nice grab by Huff. Thought I got past him. He was playing summer ball. His dad was sending recruiting videos out, and finally NC State got a chance to look at him. Chris Hart saw him play in Atlanta. He said, yeah, I had a really good weekend. It was the perfect time. He has certainly impressed the NC State coaches in a number of different ways, not the least of which has been with his toughness. He was taken infield and took a bad hop while at second base right to the face and lost his tooth. So he went in the dugout, kind of cleaned it up a little bit. He went right back out in the field. The trainer's like, wait, no. We've got to take you to the dentist. He wanted to keep playing. Backhanded pickup, force a third. And Crampton finds the third out. Nice play.
Well, that's just a heads up play there by Crampton to get the Cardinal up the field looking for some offense.
Welcome back, NC State up 6-1. Everyone found interesting things to stay busy during quarantine last year. Tim Tawa, who's coming up this inning, was one of them. He made TikTok videos with an old teammate, Will Matheson, but not like the dance ones we see. They made baseball versions. They tried different kind of stunts. This one you're watching, 5 million views. Went viral. They were shocked when they saw just how many times people had seen it. Although Tawa says he's not the real TikToker. Apparently Brock is. He likes to dance. He likes to show off. Tawa just likes to play baseball on camera.
I mean, what happens if you drill your buddy in the back of the head?
There's no way that's a baseball.
I think, is that a real baseball?
No. Please tell me
You got to watch it 5 million times to figure out. Johnny Butler. Pardon me, Eddie Park taps out. Tawa was a fantastic and well-decorated athlete in high school. Mentioned the fact that set a state record as a quarterback running spread offense, West Lynn, Oregon. Prep records in passing yards and touchdowns. State runner-up on the baseball field twice and won a couple of state championships on the hardwood. It helped that he was playing with an NBA guy. Peyton Pritchard, now with the Celtics, was on that squad.
That always helps.
Oh, now he's not going to be able to get rid of me. I'm going to wait till I see Tawa again. He's going to call security on me.
Here's a ground ball to second. And let me tell you this. His record as a starting quarterback from third grade through high school, 93 wins and 8 losses.
That'll get it done.
It usually gets it done.
That'll get you in the starting lineup. And he played with Peyton Pritchard. Are you kidding me? Like, you should have told me that yesterday, Tom. Where were you? You got to give me that info earlier.
He was here at the College World Series in eighth grade. Watched Oregon State beat Indiana 1-0 in that game. Conforto and Schwarber combined to go 1-for-8. So he didn't see the best of the best.
Well, and let that be a note to all the future big leaguers here this week playing. Like even a couple big league stars.
Mm-hmm.
Can struggle here College World Series.
Now here's Brock Jones. Little dribbler's going to stay fair. Nice pickup across the bag by Murr. 1-2-3 frame work by Reed Johnson. He has been magnificent. That was a six-pitch sixth.
Austin Murr, one of the best first basemen in college baseball, making an awkward play look easy. Pick it up before you step on the bag there, left-hander.
From Omaha, Nebraska, the NCAA College World Series presented by Capital One. 6 innings complete. North Carolina State has a 6-1 lead on Stanford. And Johnny Butler will lead off the seventh. He's driven in 4 of State's 6. NC State does not have a long and storied College World Series history. They have had great players come through, Rodon and Turner, Dan Plesac, Andrew Kinzer. And head coach Sam Esposito back in the day, who never had a losing season in 21 years as a head coach, originally brought NC State here in 1968. Afterwards, he was talking about being here as an underdog team, and he said, you know, the tournament meeting, all the head coaches primarily just wanted to talk about what uniforms they were going to wear and what combination. So they go around the room and they say, well, we're going to wear the gold pants, the white shirts, or the red shirts, and the white pants, every combination you could think of. And every time it came to Esposito, he said, I think we'll wear the white unis with red pinstripes and red socks, because those are the only uniforms they had.
Makes the choice easy, right?
Yeah.
Ball 4.
90 mile an hour fastball up and in, and Johnny Butler reaches. It's a second walk. Three batters face for Quinn Matthews out of the Stanford pen.
Well, that's kind of the knock on Matthews. If you looked at his numbers when he came in, he had 30 walks and just about 60 innings pitched. The stuff's good. And we've seen a fastball up to 92, a breaking ball to change up, but sometimes the command is just not there. And there's a good example of it. 10 balls and just 14 pitches.
And so Joey Dixon now getting loose. Tatum trying to drop a bunt down, and it goes foul.
Well, you like to play. Left on left. Tatum not swinging the bat great today. One of the fastest players at the College World Series this year. Used to play receiver and defensive back in high school. Can really, really run. And, boy, this is a pretty good time. Try to bunt for a hit, and if you get him over, you get him over. Guy like Tatum, he could sack one and still beat it out. Mm-hmm. He runs that well. This is where, Ben, if you have the slug bunt in your bag of tricks, if you can bring it with you towards the second baseman right there in that Bermuda Triangle.
Yeah, and it's a good time because you got a left-handed pitcher that obviously falls off towards the third base side. So if you can get it hard enough to get it by him almost directly at the second baseman.
Nothing you can do about it. Put it in your pocket. I mean, Bowser's charging, right?
It's so a base hit, yeah.
If you bunt it to Bowser, you better deaden it. But if you can slug it up in that space between the pitcher and the first baseman, Tatum will walk into first base.
Pitch low to Tatum. 2 balls and 2 strikes. Talking about how he played here.
2-2.
With a youth team and 4 guys back. And they played for Brent Rooker's dad, Terry, Memphis area team, the Giants. And those guys not only still playing, but playing in this College World Series. Tennessee's Evan Russell, Vandy's Hugh Fisher, and Mississippi State's Houston Harding, the other. Great article on 247 Sports by Robbie Falk, breaking down all those guys today.
Yeah, I appreciate him sending that our way, because that's a really cool story. Think about it. You'd think maybe all those guys would be on the same squad, but they're dispersed on different clubs. But that's one heck of a travel team. I wouldn't want to run up against them. Something tells me they won a few games here.
Well, as you get older, I mean, that's what you see from a lot of the elite travel teams. They're not just from one area. You know, they're handpicked around the country.
Kind of like this NC State roster. Nine guys, nine different states.
Yeah.
Or to be
a couple countries.
Technically correct, yeah. Seven in two different countries.
Yeah, I mean, you look at the rosters and you would expect Stanford to probably have more of a national lineup and NC State to maybe be a little more regional, but really not the case. The Stanford team is, you know, almost exclusively, at least the players on the field, West Coast, and this NC State team is they're from everywhere.
Credit to Chris Hart, the recruiting coordinator, who's got carte blanche when it comes to how he recruits, who they spend the scholarship money on. And we asked Elliot Avan, how'd you come across Hart? He's been on your staff forever. Well, Eddie Biedenbach, former NC State player and basketball coach at UNC Asheville, called him up one day and he said, you know, I'm not asking you to hire the guy, but could you interview this guy? His dad, Dave, longtime athletic director. He said he's helped a lot of people out, Grandpa Dave too, and give him a look. They gave him a look, and originally the thought was he'd come on and be an ops guy. And he's like, I coach, all due respect, I got to be on the field. I'd rather not get paid and be your volunteer assistant than draw a salary and be your ops guy.
Yeah, I love the story. So, and when you hire him, give him a look, but and when you hire him.
Runner goes, little chopper up the middle. Running play by Crampton. And Butler advances.
But Crampton makes it look easy, too. One of the best compliments a coach will give a shortstop is he makes the hard plays look easy. And it's not I'm trying to be cool. It's just he's that good that play is so routine for him. Charges, catch and throw all in one motion, and perfect throw right to the chest of Bruiser. As Stanford trying to hang in there, post another zero. The ballpark's playing offensive. You know you got an explosive offense. You just got to hang in there. Here as the game goes to the latter innings.
Luca Tresh swings at the first, sky high, foul territory. Huff and Bruiser, and the first baseman Bruiser takes it. Leadoff man reaches, but nothing to show for it. Time to stretch. Game number one of the College World Series. This week's Sunday night baseball game is a series finale between the Cardinals and the Braves. Both teams looking to get their seasons jump started. Our coverage begins 6 p.m. Eastern on ESPN and the ESPN app with Baseball Tonight Sunday Night Countdown. Braves featuring Dansby Swanson, most outstanding player of the 2014 College World Series. Cardinals have Tommy Edman, Stanford alum, and Andrew Kisner, played at NC State from 2014 to 2016.
Tommy Edman and Dansby Swanson met up in the super regional, on Dansby's way to a national championship.
Ooh! Just late. And Stanford will have a runner on to start their half of the seventh.
Boy, Wojtek Minchik made that play closer than you thought with how high that ball bounced and how slow it developed. And I love the play by Murr. Look, put your right foot in the ground and rip it. And Murr just makes it look so easy. I tell you what, that was pretty close at first base. Man, does he make it look smooth over there. Elliot Avent telling us he nominated him for the Gold Glove, college first baseman. They're going to talk about it. Well, that one's worth a look.
Yeah, we've seen it.
Evan White at Kentucky.
Yep,
we've seen first base. Gold Glove winner with Seattle last year. They'll look at this one.
What was interesting, Ben, is I didn't feel like usually the first baseman will call for it, but I feel like he's out. What you got?
Boy, that is close. If you're Huff, you'd like to get to the front of the bag. It almost looks like he stepped
in the middle.
In the middle of the bag? Yeah, if he gets more towards the front of that bag, I think he definitely beats it out by a couple of inches.
Ball is considered caught when it hits the leather.
They may turn this over.
I'm with you. I feel like the you see the leather move before the foot has landed. The question is, did the heel land before the ball of the foot? Because the ball definitely beat the
Top part of the foot. Minchik, that was a big time play. I mean, slow roller, he couldn't do anything about it, but he got something on the throw and made it really close. So you'll see the ball disappear there, and just, that's what you can't tell, is the heel on the bag or not.
Yeah, the front part of the foot is definitely not down when the ball enters the glove.
But you can't see, and obviously, you know, that's why the call on the field is so important.
Mm. And so after review, he's safe. They're trying to get Johnson to go deeper in this game. 71 pitches at this point. Only one NC State pitcher has thrown a complete game in the College World Series. That was Carlos Rodon in the Pac's 2013 opener against North Carolina. He worked 9, allowed 5 hits, and struck out 8.
Well, that's a recipe for success, right, for NC State and their pitching staff, is they got to have their starters go deep because the bullpen is not an extremely deep bullpen.
Christian Robinson now, and he sends one high and deep into the right field corner. Gone! Two-run home run, Robinson.
Well, you knew if Stanford was going to have success, it was probably going to be the left-handers, right? Because Johnson just, he wants to throw fastball slider, just doesn't seem like he trusts the changeup. And after a call that goes the Cardinals' way, a hanging breaking ball gets deposited in the bullpen, and that is one giant swing of the bat by the senior Christian Robinson. A hanging slider just sitting right there in the middle of the plate.
And the first pitch swinging hot shot from Nick Bruiser. Three straight hits to open this seventh for Stanford Cardinal back in this game.
Well, the first base hit not hit very hard. The home run was mashed, and this is the home run, just a breaking ball sitting right in the middle of the plate. And it's been two of the breaking balls. I mean, both home runs, Tawa's home run and Robinson's home run, have been on the breaking ball by Johnston.
They're ambushing him. Three hits on the last three pitches.
You know who's getting loose. There goes Evan Justice sprinting down to the bullpen, the wipeout closer for the Wolfpack, who is such a big part of their story. Once he became their closer, everything changed for this club, and you are going to see a mid to high 90s fastball, and it is a herky-jerky, funky look. Very uncomfortable for the opposing team.
So what's the message to Johnson? You've been on cruise control through six, and then bang, 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 three hits on three pitches.
I think it was more about giving, you know, Justice a little bit of time to get loose and get down there, you know, but just kind of hit the reset button a little bit. Hey, let's get back to doing the things, because that breaking ball he threw was not a good one. And it's a sinker for me. His fastball with the sinking action has been big for him. You go back to the last inning in the sixth inning, he gets three weak ground balls, all of which was on that sinking fastball that Stanford was rolling over. So I think the message, hey, let's get back down to the bottom of the zone with your sinking fastball. It's probably been your most effective pitch today.
First six innings, Stanford offense, two hits and one run. First three batters of the seventh, two runs on three hits.
But you better be careful right here, because the freshman Bowser is as talented as any bat in this lineup. And Dave Esker telling us today he will hunt a breaking ball. That was a first pitch slider spinning up out of the zone. Be careful here.
Kicked away from the catcher Tresh, but Bruiser stays at first.
All right, 1-1.
Bowser, the freshman from Los Angeles, wasn't on campus until February. And another knock. That one took the third pitch of the AB. Four straight hits for Stanford here in the seventh.
And you got to believe that's it. I mean, just another spinning breaking ball, Ben. The breaking ball has lost its bite.
Yeah.
And at this point, you feel like Tresh goes out to the mound and slows the game down to make sure Justice is ready to go.
I'm not sure, as good as he sinks the ball, I'm not sure why he's gotten away from the fastball so much. It's been pretty much all breaking balls in this inning, where last inning he got all of his outs on the good sinking fastball.
There you go.
And that breaking ball just doesn't have the tilt. When it gets horizontal and stays on that one plane, it's the one that gets hit. When he's had a little bit of tilt to it as it goes horizontal, is the one he's got some swings and misses today. But it just seems like the breaking ball is flattened out here in this inning.
So that'll close the door on Reed Johnston, and they'll turn it over to the closer with two on and the tying run at the plate. Nobody out in the seventh. Seven saves on the season for Justice. Lefty looks ready to go. And he will enter for State. Johnson looked magnificent through six, but gives up four consecutive hits to start the seventh. Nice outing for the State ace. See if the bullpen can hold it.
Well, the day is complete for Reed Johnson, but he was good for most of this ballgame. He was able to speed the bats up and then slow it down with that breaking ball. When it had some depth to it, Berkey, it was a really good breaking ball. There's a fastball away, backs it up with another slider on the outside part of the place. He did a nice job of changing speeds back and forth, hardly threw the same pitch back to back, but this inning's been a little bit different for him. The fastball didn't really use it that much, and the breaking ball's kind of staying on plane. It's really flattened out, and boy, the third time through the lineup, for Stanford, they have made some noise.
And a first pitch swinging, hook foul by Tommy Troy. For Evan Justice, numbers on Johnson, 5 Ks and a walk. And four of the six hits coming in the seventh. Hard throwing lefty has had a hand in 16 NC State wins this season, 11 saves and 5 wins.
And it's going to be fastball slider. You'll see 94, 97 with the heater, and then he'll break off that slider. You see down at the bottom of the zone about 81 miles an hour, but he does a ton of damage with that slider. Only 154 batting average against.
Attaboy, good job.
Over his last four outings, Justice has struck out 15 and walk none. Got a save and a win in the Arkansas Super Regional.
Yeah, those numbers are a little bit deceiving. You saw that ERA over four. That's kind of, yeah. He got beat up a little bit as a starter, but when they put him in the bullpen, he's been a difference maker. And you saw the shape of that breaking ball. It's a little bit different shape. It's almost straight down vertical break with that breaking ball.
And he takes care of Troy.
Well, that didn't take long.
Really good, really good.
Justice, 68 punch outs and 55 innings pitching. There's that breaking ball. So it kind of starts. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's hardly any left to right in it at all. You can see the spin. It's got the spin of a breaking ball. There's the dot, but it's more of a straight down break versus coming across.
The shortstop, Adam Crampton, in the 9 hole for Stanford.
Oh.
95 sinking, misses low, 1-0. If they want Justice to ride it out, he'll have to do something he hasn't done all season, and that's go three innings out of the bullpen. His longest outing was four, and that was back when he was a starter against Kent State, his second appearance of the season back in February.
Well, you know, sometimes the save's not in the ninth inning, you know, and this is the part of the game right now. I mean, Stanford already two on the scoreboard here in the seventh, and he inherited a first and second situation with nobody out.
Bruiser the runner at second, Bowser at first.
But also the beauty of this format is you can run your closer a little longer than you normally would, mm-hmm. because you do get tomorrow off. And of course, these athletes smell the finish line too, right? They're going to empty their tank this week, and certainly that's the case here in this ball game. You got to go to your closer here in this high leverage situation.
Tomorrow off, win or lose. 95 for a strike, 2-1.
2-1.
Two home runs in the season for Crampton. They both came in conference play. Three and one.
Well, we saw a 2-0 gutter ball. I mean, a fastball right down Broadway. And Crampton looked like he had no desire to swing the bat. Now a 3-1. You got to be feeling comfortable. You're the tying run. Let's see if he lets it rip here.
Line drive, left field. Bruiser to third, Bowser to second, and Stanford has loaded the bases in the seventh.
There you go. Let it rip. That was an aggressive move to a fastball that ran in, but a real short move to the baseball. And here you go, the top of the order with the bases juiced. Big time moment right here for the Cardinal.
Leadoff hitter Eddie Park coming up, 0-for-3 in this game.
What spot?
You got a pinch hitter. That makes sense here, left on left.
This will be Brett Barrera. Stanford has had success with the bases loaded this season. 7 grand slams for the Cardinals. So here we go, 3-run game, and the base is loaded in the bottom of the seventh.
Coming into this at bat, Brett Barrera, 0-for-8 on the season versus left-handed pitchers. But there is some real thump in there. Gives you a chance to run one out of here and take the lead. You just never know.
God. Mm-hmm. 96 on the edge.
One on one.
Barrera 2-for-6 as a pinch hitter this season. Try to bring it back. 2-2.
And this is what we missed, isn't it? The crowd on the edge of their seat with every pitch. The base is loaded. Seventh inning. Big time ball right here in game one of the College World Series.
Yeah, you got to think Justice is going to that breaking ball. I mean, the fastball is a good one, but when he gets that breaking ball, he can start it in the zone. He's got a swing and a miss every time.
Time called. Came from the second base umpire. Took strike three. Two down.
That's big time. That is big time right there. Slowed the bat down twice with that breaking ball, and then paints a heater at 96 miles an hour. So you start him off fastball, ball one, down and away. Comes back, makes a good pitch with the fastball to even it up. And there's the breaking ball to go to 1-2. Tries the backdoor breaking ball. Now it's 2-2, and a lot of work away, and just paints the outside inside corner. I'm not sure it was supposed to be there because it looked like the catcher, Tresh, had set up on the outside part of the play, but regardless, it works.
Tim Tawa looks at a 95-mile-an-hour strike at the knees.
And I've always thought the best sequence in baseball, no matter if you miss a spot or not, is slow, slow, fast. If you can slow the bat down twice and then throw your fastball, normally it works.
Oh!
And I can't imagine a hitter that the Cardinal would rather have up here than the senior 21. Second baseman. 5 home runs in 7 postseason games. The Palo Alto Regional Most Outstanding Player gets his chance to make his mark here in game one.
3-for-7 with the bases loaded this year. 2-1.
Two and one.
Eighth batter of the inning.
Ground ball.
Booted by Minshee. Run home, and he almost threw it away. Wojtek Minshee couldn't pick it up clean. Stanford will keep the line moving.
I'll tell you what, man, the surface is playing fast, and that ball was hit on the screws, and it just eats him up, Ben. A bullet. Minshee tries to go down to a knee to just corral it, and this thing ricochets just too far off to make a play. But that's a one. If you're on the mound, you got to have that one,
yep.
Huh, Ben?
You want that one.
Brock Jones has a grand slam to his name in the postseason already. Homered three times against Texas Tech last week in one game, including the granny. Three-hole hitter for Stanford is 0 for 3 in this game.
Boy, and it's been some big errors made in this ball game by these two defenses. And you're talking about two of the best in the country. I mean, NC State, number two defense in the entire country. Stanford at 10th in the country.
Pops him up. Coming in from third is Minshee. He'll call everybody off, and he squeezes that one. Stanford missed opportunity in some ways. Yeah, they get three across, but they leave the bases loaded. It's a two-run game through seven in Omaha. New pitcher into the game for Stanford, Zach Gretsch, the sidearm closer, is going to enter for the Cardinal. Unique name, unique delivery. We got the name right. Now we get to watch him throw.
Well, I tell you, Quinn Matthews did his job, right? He came in. It wasn't pretty, but he did a job. He hung, got out of one inning and hung another zero and gave this Stanford offense an opportunity to climb back in it, and that they have.
Devontae Brown homered in the fourth. He will lead off for NC State in the eighth. We've got a new game. It's a two-run Wolfpack lead. Gretsch 5-5 with a 3.17 ERA. And look at the impressive numbers. 3.66 undergrad GPA, 4.01 grad school GPA.
That's called raising your game.
Right? Yes, it
Stepping up right there.
It is, right. He'll start with Devontae Brown. Brown's home run in the fourth was his 13th of the season. For a strike to Brown. Grant Burton is the new center fielder for Stanford. And Brock Jones has moved from center to left when Eddie Park was pinch hit for. Tawa handles it. One down. Minshee had a ball that was misplayed, hit Adam. How is this infield different than what these guys might be used to?
Well, I just think this time of year, and we know that turf is more prevalent now than at any time in college baseball, so there are more reps on a surface that's probably more predictable. Also, this time of year, when you get in where the sun is baked out a field for 2.5 hours and there's spike marks all over the place, those bullet ground balls tend to have a lot of topspin and can really climb up your wrist. And Minshee, you know, centers the ball, stays over the ball, but the ball climbs up his wrist and ricochets off. And it is a tough task for the infielders, maybe now more than ever, because they don't play on as many natural surfaces as they used to.
Exactly. You know, we were doing the SEC tournament, and we saw that field get baked a little bit, and balls on the second hop, third hop in the infield, like you said, starting to hit some of those divots with a lot of topspin and ball coming up.
Menchik sends a fly ball into right field. Robinson pushed all the way into the corner, and it's past his reach. And I believe it hopped over the fence for an automatic double. Wojtek Menchik.
I just don't think Christian Robinson thought this ball was hit that hard. It looked like, Ben, he was not on cruise control, but not at top gear. And then at the end, he, you know, tries to lunge for it and wasn't quite able to finish the play. But it never looked like, watching him live,
there was the urgency.
The urgency to get to that baseball.
And don't forget, see the ball off the right-handed bat slicing away from him the entire time, too. So he's trying to play catch-up after not a great jump. And that ball was really sliced off the bat by Menchik.
NC State trying to get one back after giving up three in the seventh. Here's JT Jarrett. That's a first hit for NC State since the fourth inning.
Interesting thing about Gresh is normally when you see sidearm submarine right-handers, it's fastball and a frisbee slider. With Gresh, it's a changeup. The number two pitch is the changeup. And so not maybe as tough of an at-bat for right-handers as normally you would think of as a sidearm right-hander because you don't have to deal with that breaking ball flying away from you.
Jarrett struck out in the second, reached on a fielder's choice in the fourth, and was walked in the sixth. Bowser playing even with the bag at third. To Bowser. A glance, and he'll take care of Jarrett. One down. The Euros continue tomorrow morning with Group A simultaneous matches. First place Italy takes on Gareth Bale and second place Wales on ESPN. And the Swiss square off against Turkey on ESPN2. Both matches also available on the ESPN app. Begin at noon Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific with our pre-match coverage starting at 11:30 Eastern and 8:30 a.m. Pacific. There was a rooting interest for Menchik during the game yesterday. He walked by the monitor in the press box with his Czech Republic trailing Croatia 1-0. They bounced back to pull out a tie.
And half the game so far have been 1-1 ties?
yesterday, yeah. Three of them yesterday, that's right.
I'll preserve comment.
Here's Austin Murr. It's a little late for that. 2-for-2 with a couple of walks. Murr single in the first, walk in the second, single in the fourth, walk in the sixth. In for a strike. NC State led this game 6-0. They have one loss this season when leading by six or more. Back in February 23rd, led UNC Greensboro 7-0, ended up losing that game 16-13. This one will reach the seats past Bowser's would be right reaching into the first row.
And every year we come to the College World Series, the foul territory plays a factor. That ball didn't get out by much. But we'll see the arm side run here from Gresh. Is that two-seamer starts middle. And that one actually kind of hung there. He's looking for that ball to run to the arm side. And it just sits. And really a missed opportunity there for Murr on a fastball that caught a lot of the plate.
It's the last time we saw a great Stanford pitcher pitching glasses.
I know a guy. Mayor himself.
Yeah.
Kyle Peterson, surely we got a shot we can pull up.
Yeah, I don't know.
One and two.
Speaking of our friend KP, Tim Tawa, Stanford second baseman, lists his favorite social media follower as KP Omaha.
There you go.
That is an easy way to curry favor with the broadcasters and get them to say something nice
about
it.
Well, KP had us over for dinner last night, cooked some steaks. And I'm not sure he really cooked them. Like, he just threw them on the
served them.
He served them. Like, they were on the pit for blink your eye and they were off.
Uh-huh.
They were good.
To first, scoop by Bruiser, and he'll take it to the bag. Steak still sitting with you, Ben?
It's doing all right.
We got a dandy in the nightcap, Kumar Rocker. Top five pick in this July's MLB draft, we presume, and a most outstanding player. The last time we played the College World Series will be on the mound for Vandy. He's half of a 1-2 punch that includes Jack Leiter. They've each thrown no-hitters in their Vanderbilt careers. You had a chance, Ben, to run into Jack's dad, Al, today.
Yeah, I saw Al in the hotel and got to visit with him a little bit. Also saw these two guys in a Super Regional there in Nashville against East Carolina. And I'm telling you what, it is a smoke show when they're out there. 1-2 in the country in strikeouts, and both expected to be, you know, top five, top six picks in the draft just a couple of weeks away.
Haven't had two teammates go that high since Bauer and Cole with UCLA back in the day. Five seed Arizona, four seed Vanderbilt. Next game up here on ESPN. Cody Huff, 1-for-3 in this game. Huff, Robinson, and Bruiser come up. They're part of a run of four consecutive hits to open the seventh against NC State starter Reed Johnston. Huff, sophomore from Scottsdale, Arizona, middle infielder in high school, moving behind the plate. Sends this one into shallow left, and Torres has it. Well, it'll be strength versus strength, like a heavyweight title fight, tail of the tape tonight between Vanderbilt and Arizona. The Wildcats offensive, Vanderbilt shutdown pitching.
It's going to be fascinating to watch. The Vanderbilt offense is probably more talented than we talk about just because of the 1-2 punch that they have in Rocker and Leiter. But there is no doubt the Arizona offense is as formidable as any in this field. And so Kumar, as great as he has been, and he has been great, he will have his hands full,
no
1-9 tonight with the Wildcats.
You know, and the question is going to be, can the Wildcats, can Arizona lay off the slider in the dirt? Because that's where Kumar makes his hay, is with that slider.
Poked into the seats, foul. Nothing in two to Christian Robinson, who homered in the seventh. Try to ignite the Stanford comeback. It's a two-run deficit here in the eighth.
There's definitely some matchups to watch in that game, but you think about as hot as Dante Williams has been and Daniel Susak, those are two guys that I got circled. Kumar, you know, is going to pay a lot of attention to those two.
Robinson looks at 95. Big time strikeout for Evan Justice. And Ben, now the question is, how much can they get out of Justice? Can he take it the rest of the way?
Yeah, and obviously if he keeps his pitch count down, I think that's the idea. I mean, the pitch count, what, at 27, 30 pitches right now. But it's a big time arm. We heard a lot about it. First time I'm seeing him in person, and fastball's up to 96. And it's got some movement. It's got some late life to it right at the end. But the breaking ball, that one right there is kind of the difference maker. It's got that nice vertical break, and it's almost a straight down type pitch. And obviously when he gets ahead, he can really spin that breaking ball.
How does he get that run?
Well, most lefties in Berkey tell you that that's pretty much the usual run for left-handers. A little bit from right to left. That's kind of the natural movement. It looks like to me he likes to stay down in the strike zone because everything we see is down with him. So it's probably not a high spin rate as far as the vertical break we talk about and the high spin rate fastballs. But he understands where his stuff plays the best, so you see him down. But the key for him is being able to start that fastball at the knees. And when he gets ahead, he can throw the breaking ball right out of the same window, start it at the knees, but instead it's bouncing on top of home plate and he's getting strikeouts.
See how he approaches Bruiser here with two down. The 1-2. And that was a breaking ball in the dirt. Bruiser lays off of it. Nick Bruiser 1-for-3 in this game.
All right, 2-2.
And obviously Justice has made a big-time adjustment to the back of the end of the bullpen. But you look at the way he can throw that arm side fastball and bounce that glove side breaking ball. It is a tough combo for a right-handed hitter to defend.
Murr will give it a look and another souvenir. Oh, we got to stay on our feet, fellas.
What we got here?
Uh-oh.
Man. We got some collateral damage there.
That's dominoes in there. That first domino goes, they all going. That's a little bigger domino than most of them over there.
Travis Katzenmeier wore it.
He's not happy about that. That got him.
This one skip off in front of the plate.
Ooh. Ooh.
Take a listen.
Yep. That's the sound it makes when it goes below the equator. I'm just telling you.
we really replayed that twice.
The audio told you all you needed to know about that one.
My man gets a lot of credit for the bounce back. I mean, that was a very quick bounce back.
He's off the canvas quick. 3-2, fouled off again, and Bruiser battling in there. Nick Bruiser, three-time first-team All-State at a Hamilton High School in Chandler, Arizona, where one of his assistants was Clay Bellinger, former big leaguer. Got real power. Here's the payoff. Strike three called at the bottom of the zone. Back-to-back K's for Justice. Stanford down in order in the eighth, and we head to the ninth. Ninth inning of game number one of the College World Series, and NC State led this one 6-0 at one point. Stanford with a three-run seventh to pull back closer. Look high above TD Ameritrade. College World Series presented by Capital One, and it's a 6-4 NC State lead. Johnny Butler's due up second this inning. He's driven in four of State's six. Here's Tyler McDonough. And McDonough muscles one towards left center field. He's got his second hit of the game, and he motors his way towards second. He is in head first.
Do it, kid.
Tyler McDonough doing his best. Trey Turner.
Trey Turner. Elliot Abent likes to call him Charlie Hustle, right? He's from Cincinnati, Ohio. Kind of says he's their version of Pete Rose, and you knew it. He was hunting it right out of the gate. Gets another one of those two-seamers sitting in the middle of the plate, and just a beautiful move. And watch it. As soon as he finishes making contact with that ball, he is hunting that double in the left center field gap. And then pays it off with the head first slide.
Here's Johnny Butler. Two-run home run in the first. Little bloop single in the fourth. They had first base open when they pitched to him in the fourth.
I mean, that's the last time they scored. You just think about it right now. The best hitter in the lineup was up with two outs and runners on second and third. And I know you trust your senior right-hander, who's the Pac-12 pitcher of the year, Brendan Beck, but, you know, the pitch just caught too much of the plate. Butler made him pay, and that's the difference in the ballgame right now.
Butler sends this one into the seats. ACC's leading hitter came in at 377. That's gone higher in this one. He's now at 381.
You think about the opportunity, and at that point in the game, Terrell Tatum had punched out two times.
Yeah.
And Beck looked very comfortable against him. But they decided to pitch to him, and boy, did he make them pay.
First team all ACC, third team all American. Young NC State fan at the house. Zach Gretsch is 0-2 now.
One and two.
And Johnny Bunners has obviously some big at bats in this game, but this is a huge one here, right? I mean, you got a leadoff double. His job is to try to get a ball to the right side to move an insurance run over to third base and just have an insurance run just 90 feet away with run out.
And it'll go through. Better than that even. McDonough scoring from second. And NC State is fired up.
Well, how about that at bat by Johnny Butler? It's been one heck of a day for him. Five RBIs on the day. But he knew his job. His job with a leadoff double. You know what? I got to get a ball on the ground to the right side. And he got down 0-2, but still was able to do it. If it gets in the hole, and it did, it's icing on the cake. NC State, and you know for sure, that pitcher right there, Evan Justice, appreciates that insurance run for sure.
Terrell Tatum still looking for his first hit of the game. There is action in the Stanford bullpen. Let's take another look at what Johnny Butler was able to accomplish on his third hit of the game.
Yeah, just an 0-2 count. He's looking for a mistake, and he gets one right there. You can clearly see that ball was supposed to be down and away because they didn't want him to pull the ball to the right side. But instead, Gretsch misses a spot, leaves it right over the center of the plate, and a nice, balanced, flat swing gets it through the hole.
Gretsch really having a hard time getting that ball to his arm side. Everything right now is like he's yanking it into the middle of the plate or even to the glove side. And boy, has Johnny Butler had himself a ball game. How about five ribeyes in your College World Series debut? Yeah,
that is a career high.
And don't be surprised if he doesn't try to take second right here. Tied with the team lead, 16 stolen bases.
Sidearm submarine guys easier to run on?
Well, it all depends on that kick. But one thing you know is the ball tends to run down and away from the catcher, right? So it's not usually a comfortable catch and throw. So, yes, I would say it's a great opportunity to steal a bag.
Ball and a strike now to Tatum.
And I tell you what, if you're Tatum, you got a guy trying to sink the ball away from you, and they are giving him the entire left side of the infield. Bowser playing, you know, maybe just a touch over from normal third base, but Crampton all the way up the middle.
Whoa, 2-1.
So we're getting word 1-3. You're stealing. That's kind of borderline right there. That's right on the mark.
Depending on the type of runner you are, I mean, most runners that are big time base stealers are going to get in there 3-3 or better. So if the catcher's a 2-0 and the pitcher's a 1-3, the math's kind of neutral. Huff has not thrown the ball great so far in this ball game.
Oh!
So you feel like it'd be worth the risk, and especially to try to get yourself into scoring position. Now, maybe with the left-handed hitter, you want to hang around and keep that four hole open, but I got a feeling they're going to move Butler here in a full count.
Huff's thrown out 35% of would-be base stealers in the season. That's a good number for a college catcher. Ground ball to the right side. Tawa to second. Threw wide. Came in with one error on the season.
Wow. They don't send the runner. You're thinking this is 4-6-3. And Tawa, as he flips his hips, just doesn't finish the throw. And Crampton trying to come across that bag, hunting a double play, has to come off the bag just to keep that ball going into left field. You see the elbow drop and the ball sail. And that is another miscue by this Stanford defense.
The third one of the day, and it has cost them big time. I mean, it's already three unearned runs on the scoreboard.
So here's Jose Torres. He had the big hit against Arkansas, game three of the Super Regional with a home run in the ninth inning. And the bunt is popped up. Gretsch got it.
Oh,
what
out.
A play. Throw to first was late.
Ooh.
But if identified it early, it would have been a double play.
There's my pitcher with a little athleticism.
Wow. Boy, he had an easy double play here.
Well, you know, you're always taught to check the lead runner first, and I think that's what Gretsch does. So he comes in right here. He recognizes. He slides, makes an outstanding. But you'll watch the first move. It's up to second base. He's checking the lead runner first, but by the time he realizes it, he can't get the backside
runner. I think the runner's in his way here, Ben. I think he pumps here because Torres is between him and the first baseman Bruiser, and then he just elects to go over his head with it. That was still an awfully close play.
Yep.
Two on for Luca Tresh with one down in the ninth. And he sends a shot to the gap. Johnny Butler's going to come around to score. Tatum ran out of his helmet. He'll end up the third. RBI double for Luca Tresh, and the Pack adds another.
Boy, it just feels like every time Stanford has given the Wolfpack an extra opportunity, NC State's made a pay for it. And you can follow the errors in this ball game. When the errors have been made, Stanford's not been able to get it out. Instead, this right here has happened numerous times today. And it's an offense for NC State that is just too hot right now. And when you give these kind of offenses extra opportunities this time of the year, it seems to always bite you. And it has bitten Stanford here in the ninth inning.
Gretsch came on in the eighth. Allowed one hit, and then in the ninth, double, single, fielder's choice. Nice play on the pop-up and an RBI double for Tresh. So that'll bring Devontae Brown to the plate. Game one of the College World Series this season. Great to be back in Omaha. Stanford goes to the bullpen. They'll bring Joey Dixon in. Game one of two should be a thriller later tonight. Arizona and Vanderbilt in the nightcap. Tom Hart, Chris Burke, Ben McDonald. It's everything we missed, right? And a game that wasn't close, and it comes back to be close. We get to see great performances on both sides.
Yeah, and I tell you what, guys, we're seeing an NC State team.
Yeah.
They are a real player here in this field. Anybody that is good enough to go on the road and beat Arkansas, you know, has got some serious mojo going, and they have kept it going here early in this one.
Especially losing game one of that Super, 21-2?
Yeah.
And yet they rebounded and said, hey, we're good. And they figured out a way to go out and win. And look, they've carried that momentum after knocking off the number one team in the country into the College World Series today with a really good offense.
Well, they have taken advantage. Let's take a look at our Capital One rewarding performance. We didn't have to look hard for this one. Johnny Butler with a career high in RBIs. This guy has been on top of his game from the first inning with a two-run home run to get NC State started.
Yeah, he gets a hanging changeup and rips it into right center field seats, and that got the party started for the Pack. And then he kept it going. Two RBI single on a two-strike pitch with first base open. They elect to pitch to Johnny Butler. He makes them pay. And then how about making them pay one more time? Ground ball in the four hole with a runner on second base. 3-for-4, 5 ribbies and a bomb. And he is no doubt the Capital One rewarding performance of this ball game. A star playing like a star here in game one of the College World Series.
Elliot Avent said this is a must-win game for NC State. if they want to stick around for a while and keep this thing going because of their depth. It's been a wild season for the state. For more on that, here's Chris.
Yeah, they started out at 4-9, Tom, but it's a team, if you talk to them, never lost any sort of confidence. There wasn't like this aha moment. There wasn't a team meeting. It was just a gradual never losing faith. And when you spend time around these guys, I've been listening to their dugout since the very beginning of this game, have a confidence, have a kind of a swagger about them. They said 2 years ago, we started 19-0 and we thought we were great, but then fizzled out. So it's not how you start. Clearly, it's how you finish.
Is it fair to call him a sleeper this week?
I don't see how you can call him a sleeper when they dominated the Ruston Regional and then beat the number one team in the country, right? Maybe off the radar because they weren't a national seed or whatever, yep. But there's no way anybody in this field is sleeping on NC State.
They don't have much College World Series history, just their third trip to Omaha. Here's Joey Dixon facing Devontae Brown. And a first pitch strike. Brown homered back in the fourth.
Let's go, Derek.
Bounce back performance for Brown. He didn't have a hit in the Super Regional, went 0-2. But in that Ruston Regional, when the ball was flying out of the ballpark, he homered three times. Half of his hits left the yard, drove in seven.
But all that NC State offense did in Ruston was put up 30 runs in three games.
Yeah. I mean,
that's a statement. They beat Alabama 8-1, knocked off Tech 8-3, and then 14-7 in game three of that one.
Ball! And guys, it's 8-4. Are you a little surprised the infield's back?
Yes.
I mean, you're down 4 in the ninth with an out. Like, it feels like to me you got to keep it right where it's at. I was very surprised they're going to concede a run here with contact to the middle. Really, even contact to the corners, you're conceding a run. Anything on the ground would be a run right here.
There's ball four to Brown. We're talking about the surface playing fast. What role does that have in whether in or out in this situation? Seems like range is limited no matter what.
That's the way I see it. I say, look, you're pretty much only catching balls that are in a very small space anyway, so why not bring them in and make sure they don't get a cheap one? But now you got the bases loaded. You got to force out everywhere and chance to turn double play, get off the field.
Missed opportunity on a double play earlier this inning on an error. And Wojtek Menchik at the plate. Hot shot past Bowser. Tatum will score. Trash around third. Wojtek Menchik drives in two with a ninth inning single. Not bad for a guy from Brno, Czech Republic, who said it back home, it's hockey, it's soccer, baseball, way down the line.
Well, maybe not so much with what he's doing. You know what he's doing is going to create a lot of interest there for sure. He rifles this ball right by the third baseman, Bowser, and the Wolfpack just playing a little add-on here in the top of the ninth inning.
Here's JT Jarrett. Ben, you ever been to the Czech Republic?
I have not.
His dad, Mirek, is a university lecturer. Played for the Czech national team. Two and oh.
Now, guys, don't. I'm not. This is not a apples to apples comparison, but more of just a similarities. JT Jarrett, I'm just going to go ahead and throw it out there. My guess is his favorite player is Dustin Pedroia. I don't think I've ever seen a stance and a move to get ready to hit more similar than this guy to Dustin Pedroia. I mean, it looks identical. Watch him start vertical, and then he'll sink into his legs just like Pedro used to do. Pedroia did wear 15.
Yep. 5'10", 160s,
about the same size, too.
And I just, like, I'm watching him now. It's, you know, Pedroia didn't bat ninth too much in his life, probably ever. But it is insane how much he looks like Dustin Pedroia.
We'll get the professor, Mike Rooney, to talk about it tonight, perhaps on the ACC Network. In for a strike, 3-1.
Of course, Dustin Pedroia, the legendary player from Arizona State and the Boston Red Sox, just officially made his retirement this year, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. And, of course, Willie Bloomquist, now the head coach at Arizona State University. I'm sure Dustin and him will be exchanging notes on that program, where it needs to get to.
Second walk from Dixon in three batters' face. State's loaded him again. They'll send nine to the plate here in the ninth. And it doesn't look like Dixon's day will continue. Stanford, we have back at the bullpen. Brandon Beck, the starter, struck out 10 but allowed six runs. Only three of them earned. Not a great day for the Cardinal. They trail by six in the ninth. It's great to be back in Omaha. And lifetime memories made, win or lose. And Stanford on the short end of this one. 10-4 with Austin Murr coming to the plate for NC State here in the ninth. Cardinal back to the bullpen. Austin Weiermiller making his 22nd appearance, 2-0 with an ERA of 6.46. Errors have loomed large for Stanford throughout this game. Three of them. Austin Murr, 2-for-3.
And you just can't hardly expect a performance like this from a defense that has been this consistent, not to mention a team that just was lights out last week in Lubbock. But you just don't know how people are going to respond, especially up against this quality opponent. But it just has been a very atypical performance by the Cardinal today. And what really stings is it's a two-run game going to the last.
Yeah.
Like, you got a real puncher's chance headed to the last, and unfortunately, things have unraveled for him here in the ninth.
Murr, 2-for-5 with the bases loaded this season. One and two.
One and two.
Strike three called. Big out in the ninth. Tyler McDonough will come to the plate for the second time this inning. Remember how this inning started. McDonough sends a shot towards left center field, and he never broke stride coming out of the box. Hustles his way to second base. Ends up scoring a couple plays later and brings an incredible amount of energy to NC State.
Yeah, that's what he does. He is definitely their energy guy. And Elliott Avent thinks he's going to play in the big leagues at second base, but he thinks so much of JT Jarrett that he feels like the defense is just better with Jarrett at second and McDonough in center field. But this is a young man got a chance to play this game for a while. Brings a ton of energy and athleticism and can really swing the bat from both sides.
Had an 11-game hitting streak that covered portion of the ACC tournament and the Ruston Regional. Well, that was snapped Saturday at Arkansas.
Ben, when you're wanting to close out a ball game, would you rather just three up, three down? Let me go get the last three outs, or you're okay with the boys putting four on the board? I mean, how do we feel about that?
Well, I'm starting to question, and it looks like he is going back in. But wouldn't you want to take him out in this situation with a six-run lead, and maybe go to your second guy in the bullpen, or you really just want to close it out? But you know, if I'm in a groove and feeling good, and I got my good stuff today, it's like just give me one and let me back on the bump, like, because it's over, you know. But it never hurts to sit there and see runs go on the scoreboard for you.
Ball's in two strikes to McDonough. He understands he can only throw one of those three when he gets back out there, right?
That's what I'm thinking.
Ben used to hold seven in the dugout.
He got three.
Something tells me he could hold a few more too, Ben.
That's some long fingers there.
Into left. Here's Brock Jones. NC State sends 10 to the plate in the ninth. Pack have opened up a lead, and they'll face the bottom of the order for the Cardinal, leading by six in the ninth. The NCAA College World Series is presented by Capital One. What's in your wallet? Bottom of the ninth, last chance for Stanford. They gave up a four spot in the top of the inning. It's now a 10-4 NC State lead. And Evan Justice looking to pick up his third inning of work out of the state bullpen. First pitch popped up and foul. Big one coming tonight, Arizona and Vanderbilt. Kumar Rocker will be on the hill for Vandy. Carl Ravitch, Eduardo Perez, Kyle Peterson on the call with Chris Budden down on the field. Ben, you mentioned the dinner. Kyle was nice enough to fix us at his home last night.
It was good, and the company was great, and I appreciate Kyle doing that. It was a good time.
Bowser with a leadoff single, his first hit. It was the first time, though, I'd ever had a dinner where the appetizer was steak on a stick. The entree was a steak with bacon-wrapped asparagus, and dessert was also red meat.
There was a lot of protein there, a lot of meat.
Not a lot of green in the menu, but that's kind of Kyle's
MO. It was red meat night is what it was.
Welcome to Omaha.
I have a feeling that won't be the last steak either.
Here's Tommy Troy. He is 1-for-3. And he looks at a first pitch strike.
Come on, Tommy.
Yeah, I had a mishap, and I went to let somebody in. They rang the doorbell, and Kyle's dog got outside. And when that dog got outside, I'm telling you what, he would run around like his butt was on fire. And I didn't think we was ever going to get him back in. But we finally corralled him. He had a lot of energy when he got out the door. It's like hadn't been let out in like 3 days.
Why would a dog leave a house with so much red meat?
That's what I was wondering.
Well, because KP hadn't taken him for a walk in a week.
Well, fair.
Well, he had to do his business, and that's why he wanted outside.
Troy at the plate now. By the way, Chris was talking about the TikTok earlier in this game from another Stanford guy. Tommy Troy wants you to know that he makes fire beats in his dorm room. So you go subscribe to his YouTube channel.
Okay. Now, I mean, it's good to hear that when you go to Stanford and play baseball, you still got time to have fire beats rolling.
Yeah.
But these guys do have some free time.
Well, free time can be spent watching some Stanford swimmers across the street. U.S. Olympic team trials ongoing. Ledecky et al. Over there. Oh, bobbled by Torres and has no play.
Man, what's up with the defense today? Couldn't get a whole lot better than Taylor made on that one, huh?
And he caught it. He lost the transfer, Ben. Look, he catches the ball. It's a clean catch. And he just loses the grip as he's going to transfer it. Now, there's a lot of ways to make an error as a shortstop. But rarely will you see a shortstop just lose it on the flip. Very unfortunate right there, because that was tailor-made.
Stanford sent a pinch hitter up. Down six now. Two on with nobody out. Lineup about to turn over. This is Carter Graham getting a chance to hit.
Yeah. Thank you.
Graham sends a fly ball to left field. Butler's got it. One down. Then we'll get the first plate appearance from Grant Burton.
I just saw something that I love to see from pitchers, which is Evan Justice just got that out after Torres mishandles the exchange, and he points at his shortstop, and his shortstop points right back at him with this, "I got you, man." Like, mm-hmm. We're good. And that is a – as an infielder, nobody feels worse than you when you kick one, especially a double play ball. But, man, it fills you up when the pitcher – keeps his body language, keeps his cool, and picks you up and points at you. Like, that will really make you run through a wall for a guy on the ball.
That's a veteran move. That's right. Of course, it's a lot easier to accept when it's 10-4.
Fair. But there's something to that. And for all the pitchers out there listening, I'm just telling you, you want your infielders to love playing behind you. Keep your body language and pick them up after an error. And it is a different deal for an infielder when you know your pitcher is not going to sulk when you mishandle a ball.
Well, I think sometimes people need to be reminded, even big leaguers. Here's a ground ball to second. A little bit late, but the tag seemed to get him in the jersey. Oh, it's a double play to end the game.
Did slide.
They'll get interference on Tommy Troy. Turns into an automatic double play. David Esker out to ask about it, and they'll keep NC State off for a moment. And they want to go back and take a look at it.
Well, you got to love the play by Jared here. Watch the backhand flip. And the it is definitely in time, but he doesn't slide. Got slide into the base. And he certainly makes contact with Torres. And Billy Van Rapphorst.
All over it.
All over it.
Yep. I mean, I like the aggressiveness by Jarrett. I thought he might have gone to first base and get the sure out, you know, in a big lead. But he decides to go right behind him. And I think that's the problem was. The problem was is Troy running to second base wasn't anticipating the ball coming to second base, so he never slid. He thought the out was going to be over at first base.
Well, and if you're Dave Esker right now, you're asking, number one, does he have to slide no matter what? And number two, is there any room for the judgment on the fact that there's no way they're turning two there, right? Like, that's what you're asking, and that's what you should ask if you're Dave Esker.
So we'll have a review, and we'll get it situated as this crew takes another look at it. If it is interference with the slide rule resulting in a force play, then the game is over.
Mm-hmm. Well, we see it on double plays, right? You get an illegal slide. No matter if you thought they could turn two or not, if it is an illegal slide at second base, and this is not an illegal slide, this is a no slide, but it's an automatic double play where they could have turned it or not.
Yep. It could also be the fact that if you have Troy going out of the baseline in the direction of the fielder, I don't know that that's exactly what we saw, but we did see him start to come out of the baseline to go around Jarrett before the ball was tossed to second. That could also be the force play slide rule. Now remember, if the runner contacts the fielder, even if the fielder makes no attempt to throw to complete the play, it's still violation of the force play slide rule.
And there's certainly contact here because his foot's on the base, and then you see the contact there with the arm of Torres.
The first part of the force play slide rule reads that on any force play, the runner in the vicinity of the base must slide on the ground before the base and in a direct line between the two bases.
Well, that's all you got to hear. Yeah. I mean, that's it. There was no slide attempt,
first
right?
Place,
therefore, it's an automatic, right? Are you saying it's automatic double play then?
Yeah.
Okay.
The only exception is if you slide in a direction away from the fielder to avoid contact. That'll be it. Textbook. And what a weird game ends on the force play slide rule in place in college baseball to perfect protect fielders, especially middle infielders, and plays like this. Not the first time we've seen it. We saw it a couple of years ago in the championship series.
Yeah, and that's by the letter of the rule. That was perfectly executed by Billy Van Rapphorst, and this NC State club is red hot. They have all the pieces, Ben McDonald.
Yes.
They got quality starting pitching. They got an offense that just does not quit, and they got a closer that can wipe you out.
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, Reed Johnson did his thing. He throws up a quality start in that starting role for NC State, and Evan Justice does what he's done pretty much all year long out of the bullpen. He comes in and slams the door, and he goes three scoreless.
So NC State on the winner's side of Bracket 1, Stanford will play again for their season in 2 days. Coming up tonight, Arizona and Stanford, 7 o'clock Eastern for Game 2 of the NCAA College World Series, with Kumar Rocker getting the ball for Vanderbilt. Most outstanding player the last time we played the College World Series. It was won by Vanderbilt. So, for Chris Burke, Ben McDonald, Chris Budden, our fantastic ESPN crew, I'm Tom Hart. We'll see you back at 7 o'clock for the second game of the College World Series.